Let's get going here. Welcome to the Hopkinton Planning Board meeting for Monday, August 15th, 2016. Thank you very much to HCAM for taping this. Missing one member that we're expecting, and another member is gone for the entire meeting. Hopefully they'll make it here. And this is a shout out for Frank. He was not here by planned absence because this is a specially scheduled meeting, but basically, Frank, we know you're going to be watching the tape because you promised you would. Hi, Frank.
Hey, Frank.
So, tonight we have really two things on the agenda. From about 7 to 9, we're going to be meeting with three people to interview them for the peer review services. We have some questions that we want to try to ask each and every one of them. I want to try to, if at all possible, cut out about 5 minutes out of each of those half an hours, if it's possible, so we can get through some of our other business done in that kind of break time a little bit. The first 5 minutes, the first guy is kind of cut out with this discussion right here. We're working on, just for administratively, we're working on a draft decision for the school. They're up next Monday. I don't know if you all saw the article, but they're hoping that they're going to get approved next week. They still have a lot to go, and hopefully they've got answers to all their questions, but at least the drawings should be up to date because they said they were going out to bid on that following day, so there ought to be live drawings, whether they're...
I believe they're trying to get them to by tomorrow, so...
Okay, so at least they'll make their deadline. So anyway, why don't you invite the Magurie people in? Is it CDR Magurie or just Magurie? How do you...
Officially CDR Magurie. I think they just go by Magurie.
Okay.
CDR.
Jeremy.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Is it paper?
Yeah.
Please.
I sit in the back row usually.
Well, welcome to Hopkinton. You guys are one of the our three finalists at this point to try to determine who we're going to have for a peer review. We've got 7 out of our 9 members of the planning board are absolutely here right now, and why don't we start with a couple of questions.
Did you want to have to make a brief presentation?
Oh, yes. Yes. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, I know you're tight on schedule, so... let you ask whatever questions you got. If you want to give a little brief review, we can. But we did put together just a brief, quick summary of our qual, sort of a easy handout. We'll just hand over and I'll introduce ourselves and let you ask your question.
Okay, great.
My name is Stephen Laner. I'm the head of the Civil Engineering Group for CDR Magurie. Far right is Robert Sims. He'll be project manager for you. He's providing, he's managing our peer review services in Ashland right now. And Jim Coogan is our senior traffic engineer. He'll be doing a comprehensive of the traffic study, just to give you a flavor of who's here. Unfortunately, Jim Jackson, who does a lot of civil site reviews, is on vacation this week, so he couldn't make it. So that's the quick, really brief overview. Just, you know, Magurie's been around for 70 years, provided, we mostly work for municipalities, towns. Just like yourself, we're doing peer review in Ashland and Bellingham now. Just so you get it, we have offices in Milton, Providence, and Rocky Hill, Connecticut, and New England area. But just so you know, Robert's a couple towns over in Northbridge. I live a couple towns south in Bellingham, so we're also very local. So we're very familiar with Massachusetts and the Massachusetts town requirements. So I'll let you ask your questions.
It's probably in the resume. I don't know how much you looked at or not, but... worked with a couple different firms, have done work a lot of, for two different firms in Hopkinton. We did the SCADA project for the water system, bringing that up all onto fixed base network. Have done a number of other things. I was with the firm when we, I don't know if you guys remember, 97, 98, when we closed 135 in the summer to do sewer construction in Ashland. That was my project. We had a fairly large traffic management plan that we sent out to local media, all the trucking companies. I mean, it was precursor to the internet. You know, we go to the Yellow Pages and send them out there. And it worked really solid. I was the DPW enemy the first couple of days, but then by the end of the first week,
that was in what town, excuse me?
It was the West Union Sewer District, but we had the contractor working in West Union Street in Ashland, and we had a detail right in the Hopkinton Common. It was like this local traffic only. We started at 8 in the morning and went till 4:30 in the afternoon with road closed. And it's one of the top three projects in my life. It was really phenomenal. We paved. We did a leveling course on Thursday, finished it up on Friday. They came on Saturday and put the numbers in the road, and they ran the marathon on Monday, and it was fantastic. The timing couldn't have been perfect. It had a nice, straight, black road all the way down past the old high school in Ashland. So that was a lot of fun. It was a lot of work. Okay. So I have, you know,
water. Run your mustache out since then.
I have. It comes and goes. You know, I mean, men don't accessorize very well, so we have facial hair tattoos and, you know, body piercings and all. So it's facial hair.
Okay.
Anyway, side stack.
Okay.
Why
don't you take it through a typical peer review proposal process?
Yeah. So, excellent. And I say, we probably put this to good work for every town's unique, and Jim knows that. He's worked in a lot of these towns. But we put together what we sort of see is typically what happens in general. Whenever every town has their own protocol. But why don't you walk it through it, Robert?
Yeah, it's just, you know, like Steve said, every place is idiosyncratic about how they do things, you know, how the consulting gets paid, how the projects get reviewed, whether they have Ashland does like a pre-utility meeting on a submittal, just to put all the public works groups in the room. So everybody has their own thing. So, you know, you guys would have a submittal, you'd give us a call and say, hey, we have this, can you come take a look at it and let us know what, kind of your first pass on the review and what we might need to ask for as far as, fees for the review go. And then, whatever version of a contract you guys have, you know, we pretty much have 361 versions of contract, execute the contract at a notice to proceed and start going. Depending on the level of the complexity, whether it's an A&R looking for water capacity or pressure flow test or something like that, something simple we would do go straight into that. If something a little more complicated, and we have to assign multi disciplines if they're there. We would do that. Compile the discipline reports, come back to report to you guys. We'd have. For me, I would want to have some kind of discussion as what format you want that in. I mean, as an engineer, I have, OCD tendencies, so I like to see things the same way all the time, so I don't feel like I'm reading something from scratch. So if you guys have a format you'd like to follow, we certainly work with that to make it something that, because, everybody here has a job, and you get a stack packet like this, and if it's in the same format, it's easier to follow. So, in those reports, we would make them in a format that you guys were comfortable with and maximize your available time. And then different other things we could ask, do you want to communicate everything with you guys? Do we want to talk to the applicant? What's that process going to be like? We're more than comfortable to do, whatever works best for you guys.
Sometimes we find if we have a chance to talk with the applicant, we can iron out some questions we have. Get them resolved before board meeting, as opposed to have them linger to the board.
That would bring a question for me to you all. I've worked in communities where they bring the engineer and the attorney to the meeting so that there's not a lot of back and forth iteration to continue things on for a long time. And it gets expensive for the applicant, but this is in Sterling. That things went through fairly quickly because, they'd say, oh, well, we don't know what the capacity of the water main is. And they just turn to me and I'd say, no, and it would prevent a lot of back and forth. So do you guys typically do have the engineer present at the meeting or not, or just?
I'd say about 75% of the time.
Yeah.
You know. For particularly yeah. some of our larger projects.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's, let's see. Okay.
So, you know, once we, you know, got through all that, got to the point we were ready to report, get the draft to you guys, take a look at it, and get the final report. You know, like Steve was saying, we could, you know, communicate, if we communicate with the applicant to solve some things ahead of time, we will.
We encourage that.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was just going to say, I mean, we encourage you know, our peer review to be in touch, or the applicant to get in touch with our peer review to try and iron that out, because it makes it faster for everybody.
Right. And that's what we found works best through that process. Usually, and sometimes we end up with comments we're sort of all on board with. Sometimes we still have issues, and then we'll talk to you why we still have issues.
Right.
Thank you. Well, you probably see that more on the traffic side than some of the other sides. Usually, slow-mo and traffic are the ones we get into debate on.
Well, we're a pretty busy planning board here in Hopkinton, so.
Yeah, we noticed.
Hopkinton, as they say, Hopkinton is open for business.
Yeah. Well, I've been grafting for 25 years, so they were kind of the same. My take was always, you know, you need, you know, water, sewer, and open space, and grafting had that in spades, you know. I think the state hospital kind of gave my head start because nobody wanted to move to the state hospital. Once it's tough,
okay. Good question. So we get a packet, and you would obviously be getting the packet. How quickly can you provide reporting to us? You know, on from when you receive that packet,
well,
typically,
goes,
and revising, you know, and about revised plans too.
It tends to go with the complexity. I mean, you know, we just did one for Ashland that. They called us on a Wednesday and said, "No, it was a Board of Appeals submittal." And could you have this turned around, you know, by next Thursday? Yeah, sure, no problem. You know, it was fairly straightforward. I think some of the stuff we've full subdivision review. You know, I mean, I would probably again with the complexity and the other disciplines. You know, a couple 3 weeks maybe. I would think. I mean, we have our person that does all the brunt of the coordination, Robin Dyer, who's listed here. She's really good at the stormwater management and catching up to speed on all the minute details of regulations. And she's just like really good at it. And I get reports back from her fairly quickly. And then by the time it goes through everybody else, I mean, I'd say 2 or 3 weeks would be, you know, reasonable.
We typically have that kind of time, I would say, on the initial one, and then after we have a meeting within 2 weeks, you know, it's usually a Tuesday submittal for the following Monday of an update of maybe solving some of the problems. You know, it's hopefully it's not a clean slate at that point.
Yeah.
It's
right. I mean, that sounds perfectly
reasonable. We put in a 2 to 3 week review process typically from the start to get it to a board meeting, but that can change depending on the complexity and how many questions. But I think overall, that's typical what we see as we go through the process.
I mean, we looked through a couple of the the old meeting minutes just to see what kind of things were coming up, and most of the stuff I didn't see other than Legacy Farms.
I presume you have deadlines before your board meeting to get all the materials in, so that usually is what drives our time frame more than anything else.
Right, so I mean, like, you know, we have, you know, you get the initial presentation, and so, yeah, I expect it's going to take a couple of weeks. You know, and then we send them back. You know, there's some things you know that the peer review doesn't like, and things that we don't like, and you know that's when you know the applicant's going to try and hammer that out with you for the next meeting, which is 2 weeks away.
Right.
Is that unreasonable?
No, not at all.
Not at all.
Okay.
If I may, for the chair, we
got to keep down on the schedule. Let's move on a little bit more here. Do you do lighting and landscaping in-house? I think I heard traffic for sure.
We do traffic. Lighting is something that we used to have electric power, we don't anymore, so we'd have to do something about lighting. At landscape, we do some in-house, and occasionally the larger project, we'll sub that out. But
lighting or something. We have some electrical consultants that we will bring on. We still do a lot of electrical work ourselves. That's something we can do, depending on how complex it is. But we might have to bring some on board for that.
What percentage of your clients are really public sector clients as a peer review?
Of our that do
yeah,
what
yeah.
percentage of our clients do peer
no,
review?
No, yeah. if you look at your business, how much is what percentage is peer review versus public clients versus I'll say private clients?
I'd say probably 95% of all our clients are municipal or public clients. We do very little private work. I think the only private work we do now is down on the Virgin Islands, where we do work with a lot of developers that submit their plans. But we rarely have an instance of conflict of interest because we don't have any private clients in the area, right, that we do work for.
Most ones I have are water systems, Suez up in Gardner, Whitensville Water. We're doing work for them. But
a lot of your work is through Rhode Island? As well?
We do. We have offices in Rhode Island. We do a lot of work in Rhode Island DOT. We work Mass DOT. We do state agencies, DCR in Massachusetts with the Parks and Recreation, do a lot of work with them. Rhode Island DEM do a lot of work with them. Then we also have municipal clients, where it's water, wastewater, highway, traffic, roads. I do a lot of TIP projects in different towns. Cities, so
Department of Corrections, we've done a couple projects. Yeah.
But they're, as I say, 95% of our clients are municipal or town or state.
If the question is what percentage of that workload is peer review, a relatively small percentage.
It's a relic.
And does the peer review take priority over most?
Peer review, the critical part of peer review is the timing and the schedule. So
typically, yes, just because of the sense of urgency. I work on DOT projects that may have a 30-month design window.
Right.
So
you got a little buffer in there.
But Jim said, if someone gives him a traffic study for a peer review, that's his priority.
Exactly.
Yeah. So to answer your question, yes, it would, and mostly because of the quantity of the hours is typically less than what our typical project would be. So we can fill in the gaps with the peer review without really impacting any of our other stuff. And we know it's important for you guys, so for our clients, and we want that to happen, so we generally push it.
Yeah, just to get a sense, in our civil group, we do about $3 to $4 million worth of work a year. So peer reviews on fairly small value, you do a lot of them, that's a small percentage of that overall. Mm-hmm. But they do, as I say, and it's similar to when you into construction and getting shop drawings in, you got to keep the things going. Peer reviews take precedence because of the schedule that's driven by board meetings and those type of things.
There was a question I also want to follow up with, is that when you guys talk about the topics that you engage in, would the general public be able to follow you and understand exactly what it is that you are trying to convey to the board as well as to the public?
That's a good question. So when I go to speak at meetings, people always say, I had so many questions when you started, and now I don't have any. And I give it to teaching 5th and 6th grade Sunday school. Because, you're talking to kids that think they know everything, and they don't. And you're trying to teach them something without being condescending. If that doesn't sound like a Board of Selectmen, I don't know what does. So to answer your question, yes, I feel very comfortable communicating a point in a representative way that people can really understand. That's probably my strength, I would say.
I see. So, thank you.
Sure.
Lane, do you want to ask the question on fees?
I want to go through your fee schedule. And
could you just speak up a little?
Wanted to go through the fee schedule that they submitted. Okay. Have there been any changes in your personnel since you submitted that?
I think we did it by the type of personnel we would typically work on. The question is, using other people?
Is it your practice to give the board an estimate when you receive a package based on that?
Yes, we would. And a lot of times, Robin does she does the bulk of the stormwater design review, and also some of the site plan review. Robert, Jim. Coogan and Jim Jackson review and oversee and then come and present that information after they sit and work with them. So the bulk of the time is usually with some of the lower type people that are doing the work with support and oversight from their scene people, which are the gray-haired people here.
Yeah.
Just a question that just occurred to me. So when you have the people in different disciplines working on different parts, do you meld that all together, or do you just put it in a report to the board and you synthesize that all together?
I think if you can get a flavor from our samples, like we've sent to Ashland, that we sort of divide them out by the type of subjects, and they're all put into one report for you.
But we like to make it seem like it's written by the same person.
That, I guess
that's
so that's, synthesize was
that's
good.
His responsibility to pull it all together. And
you said you like to be in the meetings, you like to see the attorney so you can get along. Would there be the same representative from your company at every meeting that we request, or is it different depending upon what the content of the meeting's about?
It probably be, I can't, I mean, I could probably think of a situation where it wouldn't be me, but you know, for the it would be me.
Okay. Robert would do it, and if he wants to bring Jim to explain the traffic or Robin to bring the storm out, he'd bring along with them for some of that support, but he would be at every meeting.
Sixth grade, you said?
Fifth and sixth grade.
Okay.
That was 20 years ago. I've also had public speaking training, so I'm very, very comfortable.
When you were putting the proposal together, did you happen to pull up some of our rules and regulations for, say, site plan review?
Yes.
Any comments?
Or you went through those?
We just kind of, when you work with enough, you just kind of get used to working with whatever's there. So, and the RFP, I was a little surprised on the lighting, actually.
That was a new one rarely see.
It's something you don't come across very often, the planning board's being concerned about lighting.
We have several members of.
We were in Burrowville like 3 weeks ago, and they have a noise ordinance that's like 43 decibels.
We've chiseled out quite a bit of.
It's like the middle of the national park is going to be 43, and they have that as a bylaw. It's like.
We haven't been able to figure out how to write a noise boy law that we thought we could ever enforce.
Burrowville has one that has a lot of teeth to it. It's kind of weird. The lighting was a surprise. I mean, but then again, get used to everybody having their own little thing, so you don't really worry about it too much.
The lighting bylaw is something that just passed a town meeting last year.
Okay. So it's more the signage and the brightness and those
types of issues. Oh, this is like the variable message boards. I know Grafton went through that a couple of years ago.
No, just how bright and how, dealing with the averages.
Yeah. Interesting.
I do notice they have a lot of work coming up with the legacy farm. Is that the huge?
We've expanded our dwelling count by 28% in this decade, or on track to do that. So that's a reasonable amount.
Yeah, when I was on the Board of Water Commissioners in the Grafton Water District for 17 years, we went from 2,500 customers. 4,700 customers in that time span.
If I may, back to the money thing, did you, Elaine, my name is Cliff, by the way, did you ask them, how they rate their hourly and how does that unfold for us?
No.
Gentlemen, if, you're doing it at an hourly rate, I assume? So what constitutes an hour, and then what constitutes the overall project?
Well, typically we will budget out based on a review how many hours we think we'll do, and we wouldn't exceed those number of hours without telling you that there's going more. And then we can do time cards down to a quarter hour or a half hour, but typically, when we're working on something, it's usually longer stretches than that. But we don't typically charge less than a half an hour to a job. A 15-minute phone call, that's not being billed. We don't bill like lawyers. The phone rings, we bill. So we're sitting down working on it for stormwater. Takes it a day to do the storm review. That's the 8 hours.
So to that point, so you can pretty much determine how long it's going to take you to assess a job or peer review a job and say, well, you can work within these parameters this amount of time, given a give or take, and being within that ballpark that is very close.
The big thing is how many times I go back and forth on reviews.
I just finished peer review, and I'm afraid the applicant's going to go back and kind of reconfigure their whole driveway system, and it's going to be another submittal. You can't anticipate that until you actually perform the review, that it'll have different effects and permutations down the road. You can't see that coming. But as far as us being able to do a major review and budget a little bit to make sure that our
back and forth
suggestions are followed through,
right,
that we can fairly accurately.
We know we've done it enough that we know what it's going to take to do those things. A resubmittal or a complete change.
And the last to follow up that question is how do you view Hopkinton comparatively to the rest of your clients? Looking at, you must have done your homework for us. We have done for you. How do you view Hopkinton as being a primary candidate for client relations?
I'd love to have you guys for a call. I mean, between the work I've done in the past, been around here, done work in Framingham and Ashland, Upton, Whitesville, you guys,
you see what's going on here, right?
Okay.
I have for a while.
Ken, I need to ask these questions.
I have for a while.
We have very limited time. Through the chairman.
I understand.
Through the chairman.
Right. But let me finish, please. So, go ahead with that again. No.
Oh, just, I have a sense of community, and I take my job seriously, and I treat a community that I work in like a community I would live in. I can't help it. It's who I am.
Yeah, okay. Compared to other things, we have clients that are sporadic with asking us to call us up. We might see something every few months they might call us up. Yes, we see a lot more potential here from all the months of work, so it's something that we're very excited to try to be involved in with you here.
That's what I'm looking to hear is that you must see what's going on, and we've got a big, big ball in front of us. And that
that's why we submitted, and that's why we're put on some effort.
I'd like to say thank you.
Yep. Thank you very much.
We've got a tight schedule today. It's been a long night. I appreciate your time.
Thank you all.
Thank you, gentlemen.
I appreciate you coming in.
Thank you.
So.
Okay, great. Thank you.
And if you have any other questions, feel free to call. My cell number's on the thing.
Great.
Appreciate after 6:30 and before 10 o'clock.
Okay.
Unless you call and say we got the job, you can call anything.
Great. Thanks. Thank you.
If you need any help with that work in the Brennan Islands, just let me know.
Yeah. I
keep asking. I've been here almost 6 years and I haven't gone yet.
Next.
Thank you so much. Nice to meet you.
Oh, yeah.
We're trying to make sure that we ask all the same questions to all three of the clients as part of the fairness aspect of it. Oh. Oh my God!
I was gonna say,
what the hell are you doing here?
Who's this? The new and the old movie.
We'll explain.
Okay.
Coming back for round two.
So I have some handouts here.
Okay, we'll pass those out here.
So this is the new Andy Ogilvy. What happened to the old Andy Ogilvy? I rather.
Yeah. Is he still available?
Okay. And why don't you guys start with a little brief presentation and stuff? So.
Sure.
Okay. Even for introduction.
You have another handout, Phil?
Yeah. Yes. Since I wasn't in the proposal.
Does everyone have one of these?
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I don't know how many.
Nothing.
Yeah.
go ahead.
All right. So what we have in front of you is just a handout, which we wanted to just run through, just summarizing why we felt we were, you know, the best choice, a very, very strong choice for continuing to provide peer review services to the town. So starting off with that, little bit about myself. I mean, you've certainly seen me with the new board members. You may not know me as well as some other members, but proposed project manager, I have about 30 years of experience. The time I typically spend at Beta is really doing project management tasks, and I tend to get involved in a lot of the multi-discipline projects, a lot of large-scale projects. I'm used to working with a team that requires a lot of different disciplines, whether it's roadway, traffic, drainage, stormwater, lighting. That's how I spend a lot of my time. My background technically is roadway, utility, drainage, so it's really sort of very typical civil design. And obviously we'll set the team up to complement that with whoever we need. I spent a lot of time doing peer review, as well as multiple projects, typical design projects. And a lot of that peer review, not only with municipalities, but also with state agencies. We have some ongoing contracts with MassDOT to do peer review of roadway, traffic, civil type projects for state highway, state designs. As a result of that, I've spent a lot of time working with town boards, representing towns in certain situations, obviously representing design in many different situations. As far as Phil is concerned, and Phil, you can certainly jump in here, I think some of you, perhaps not all of you, know that Andy Ogilvy, his family is relocating to Michigan. So we're sorry to see Andy go, but Phil, in a moment of great wisdom, realized that the grass is in fact greener at Beta, and after a very brief hiatus, decided to come back, and I think the timing is tremendous, because I think it will be a great fit in terms of continuing to be a principal reviewer for ongoing projects. Phil has got a tremendous amount of experience in all aspects of land development, residential, commercial, stormwater, utilities. Very experienced, really leads a lot of the work in our office in terms of permitting type activities, and spent a tremendous amount of time over the years doing peer reviews. Like me, spends a lot of time with town boards and community groups, and again, as some of you know, but perhaps not all, he was the PM before me for about 3 years, from 2012, which was our original contract. A little bit about the company. Beta is an employee-owned firm. Primary disciplines, landscape architecture, highway, civil, construction administration, asset management. We do a broad range of activities. Really a full-service firm, and in a peer review environment, we find that to be a great advantage, and we hope the town sees it. I mean, certainly know the clients appreciate it, in that we very rarely have to go out of house to complete review activities. Obviously, there's always a need in certain situations, but a lot of the time, we've got the experts right there in the office. We have over 140 employees now in 5 different offices, and in the 10 years that I've been at the firm, it's grown from about 70 to 140, and I'd like to think that that's a reflection of the work that we do, the quality that we do, and the repeat business that we get. Just going to the org chart, just showing myself here as a project manager on the civil site, stormwater side. Obviously, we'd like to have Phil playing a major role there. Matthew Crowley is another individual who's spent a lot of time working with Don McAdam on the Concom side. So Matt's not here tonight, but he'll be available also to the team. Mike Wazlewski, seeing Mike a little bit, he's the traffic engineer, and he's been reporting back to the board on the early elementary school. And again, we can draw on support there with other people, Jacqueline Centraccio. And there's other people in the office which we're not showing here, which we would also include as needed. So we've got a very kind of broad team behind these. Scott Ridd is also here on the landscape architecture side. And again, you've heard from Scott quite a bit in terms of the legacy farms development. We do have a couple of specialty services, lighting, power engineering, as we need it. wetlands, Lenore White, if there's any very specific wetlands type issues, we could bring in Lenore, who's a very experienced wetlands scientist. Obviously other disciplines, construction observation, which you leaned upon us before with Legacy Farms North Road. We did a lot of construction observations for the town there, and I think that's a very important part of an in-house skill set that we have to offer. Hazmat and wastewater as needed. So it's really a full set of services with a lot of people that you've been seeing already. Now, as far as Andy's concerned, I just want to add, although Andy is relocated, Andy's still available to help us continue just to close out the legacy review. So we aren't showing him in the org chart, but he's going to continue to be involved to the extent that he needs to be. As to why beta, you know, why do we think we're a better, stronger choice? To us, it comes down to three areas: extensive peer review experience. We think we have a very good product in the way that we report to communities that we work with. And at the end of the day, I think the importance is really good communication and good collaboration with town. And just kind of like jumping into those in a little more detail as far as our peer review experience is concerned. We've provided peer review to well over 20 communities. It's probably more than that. But a core practice is municipal. We don't work with developers, so it's very, very unlikely that you're going to see us in a situation where we're working with or opposite a guy we have a contract with in our office on something else. So I think that makes us, or enables us, to be very impartial in terms of the commentary that we would offer. We've been working with the town since 2012. We've completed over 30 reviews. We'd like to think you'd be pleased with that product. Obviously, if there's any issues, we'd like to hear about them, and we can discuss those tonight. During the course of that, we spent a lot of time working with the Concom, and I think Don is also very happy with what we've been turning back to him. As I mentioned before, everything we do, or virtually everything we do, is in-house. So no matter what you're looking for, whether it's the planning board, whether it's for the Concom, DPW, site, subdivision, stormwater, earthworks, I mean, I think you name it, I think we can identify a person who has experience in that and can jump into that as needed for the town. We've also done that on a full range of projects. Large mall developments, mixed use, overlay type situations, big box retail, childcare, schools. Again, I think we can lean on a very broad range of experience in terms of our qualifications. As far as the reporting's concerned, we report in a format that I think has really been derived over the years that the company's been doing this, and we feel that it's just a very clear, concise format that really works well in terms of communicating issues with a particular application. It really starts for us with the development of the work plan. So even before we have a contract with the town, as we get the initial submission, we're looking at the plans, we're trying to identify what we feel those key issues are, and we're trying to think about how the regulations for a particular town might fit. And that is all a service, really, before we've begun to even generate a fee. That's all
inclusive,
yeah. So we're not under contract at that point. We're thinking, we're beginning to format the actual report itself. In terms of the process, it's critical that we focus on the regulations that need to be met, and I think that provides a really important and clear roadmap, not only for the board, for the applicant too. I think, you know, with the recent school application, the initial report that we did was helpful to the town in terms of, and helpful, it's very helpful to the applicant in seeing that this, they had more to think about than perhaps they thought initially they needed to deal with, and the format of the document, and just really identifying what criteria applies, why it applies, where you didn't meet it, I think is very helpful in terms of the actual process. As a result of that, we think that working through that and sticking to that, it really improves submission quality, and at the end of the day, I think that's what everyone's really trying to achieve. As far as communication and collaboration is concerned, certainly in the brief time that I've been involved, and Phil probably can speak to this even more strongly, is I think we've know the board. I think there's certain members here I could pick out, and, you know, for example, David, sidewalks are clearly an issue for you. I've heard that several times.
I'd love my cover.
The first time I heard it with the DPW, I thought, oh, we've got to remember that. So the second time we came in with the school, because we felt the DPW had done a good job of explaining why they didn't need it, but it still wasn't enough. So next time we came to the school, we just made a point of picking it out. And there's other members too, and we can talk about those. But you know, we like to listen. We like to hear. You know, we understand what the priorities of the board are. And we're going to support those to the extent that we can. If there's something unreasonable, if we feel like you're going off in a direction which may not be advisable, we'll speak up. But it's a very strong board. There's other communities that we work with who, you know, they take an approach of, okay, what do you guys think? We'll do that. That's not the case with this board. I think you're very comfortable discussing issues, making decisions, and to the extent that we can feed into that advice, you know, that will be our approach. So where you need is to fall back on with an issue, maybe it's traffic, maybe it's stormwater. I think that's a primary role for. I think over the time we've been working with the town, we've demonstrated an ability to work well with the various town departments and with the applicant also. Not get in the way. You know, we want to help the project through. If there's something, again, that we feel is serious enough to hold something up, then, you know, we need to talk to that point. We also feel that we've done a good job staying on schedule, staying on budget. It's easy to say that, but I think we've actually done that. There's always occasions where you need to go and seek extra budget, and at the time, again, I'd like to think that we've been forthright in identifying why, and timely in identifying why we feel that the scope has changed. And at the end of the day, we feel that all of these, I guess, qualities, attributes, really enable us to be a collaborative partner and really focus on just making applications better.
Lane, why don't you take us through the standard questions we had gone, because half of these I think I already know the answer to, just because we have quite a few years of experience here. But why don't you can do it maybe in a more abbreviated, more in fair manner.
So I think you've already taken us through your approach to a review, a typical process. I don't know if anyone has any clarifying questions, but I think this one seems to be probably pretty clear on your approach. So can you talk about the timeliness of reports and how quick it takes for a turnaround of a review once you get the package?
We typically have a pretty framework in terms of when we get a submission, we like to turn around our work plan within 3 days, so that everybody knows the scope of what we're going to do and the budget we expect to spend. And so that we can have some discussion if there's any issue with any aspect, or, you know, oftentimes I'll talk, ask questions about if there are any known issues. And then after that's approved, then it's typically we have our first review within a couple weeks if it's a standard size project. If obviously it's a live project, we'll talk about the schedule. But typically within 2 weeks of that, and then subsequent to that, any kind of resubmission or supplemental revised documents that come in, we like to get that back within a week.
Keep going.
Okay. And you subcontract out the lighting, but your landscaping and traffic is in-house?
Yes.
Yep. And all of your clients from the public sector, you mentioned?
Yes, we have the occasional private client, like we do some work, for example, with universities and so forth. So we do a little private work, but we do not work with developers.
And then in looking at your fee schedule, is would Phil be the same rate that Andy Ogilvie was billed at? I think when you had submitted, had Andy Ogilvie in there.
Yes, he would fall into the same category. We hadn't gotten to the point with Phil coming back to recently where we'd actually discussed that. But if that is something that the town is looking for, you know, if there's a question on rates or an issue on rates or a concern on rates, I there's no doubt in my mind that we could get to a point where both could be happy with a right structure. And I think, you know, from my standpoint, that I'd be very comfortable as we move forward with Bill, if the board's certainly comfortable, you know, playing a leading role in these applications as much as Andy did.
I'd just like to say something about rates. We kind of structure the framework of our work plan based on what we think is the necessary effort. Like, we have a staff, you know, as you can see, the rates, there are different staff levels. And I like to employ the right staff for the right level of that. So that, you know, so when I'm not doing the whole review, we have other people doing expert, and also the opportunity to have in-house expertise that allows me to do a lot less of my own review, you know, reviewing an issue, you know, doing some research or whatever. I go to Scott and say, Scott, are these plants, you know, adequate for this? And he can look at it, you know, an hour. He can, you know, tell me, you know, what the status is. So I think what we strive to do is to have the work plan, the kind of the budget in the work plan, and not exceed that. So I think that's
it. I just want to add one other thing, because obviously rates translate into overall cost. And what I've experienced over the years, and certainly I've experienced it here in the last few months, I think that the biggest determinant on cost, in terms of a cost of a review at the end of the day, because, you know, rates translate into that, is really the quality of the application. And the applications that I've seen have been very good, very strong. Ones that are almost answering the questions the same way we will report on have been very easy to review and very efficient. The DDW was an example of that. I know we were under budget with that particular review. There are other applications which perhaps aren't as strong, aren't as organized, which are a little more costly. And I think that's a larger factor, larger issue in terms of the overall cost of us generating. The minute we have to get into kind of organizing someone and managing someone, it's a more costly process for us. So I think that's I wouldn't focus wholly on rates in terms of concerns about cost. I would think in terms of quality of submission. And I would also add that I think that one of the benefits in working the way we do, and I've seen that in certain situations, is that if you're used to dealing with a system where you're going to get a report back in a certain way, if you've got repeat applicants, they learn from that, and reviews get stronger and better, and the process becomes a little more efficient. So I think that there's other factors in there that need to be considered for, you know, when talking about cost.
And your office is in Norwood, I think?
Yes, because we're all based in Norwood. Our second office that we would really draw from a lot is Lincoln, Rhode Island.
Mr. Chair, yep. Elaine's finished. Can I ask one quick question?
Sure.
Merrick, you'll be the project manager.
Yes.
Right? So do you have multiple projects that you manage? And how many what's the range of projects that you're managing? Like 3 to 5 at any given time? It's hard to say, but.
It really does vary. In some instances, it's just one. Last year, it was really just one. Right now, my time is split between Hopkinton and a large project in Plymouth.
Okay.
So right now, it's two primary activities. That could easily change. It could be,
sure,
I would say, anywhere from 2 to 4 at any one time.
Great, thank you.
From a peer review, do you take on more than one peer review at a time as a project manager? Or, you know, I can see where you're kind of doing a design project or something like that. But, you know, Monday nights are kind of sacred to us.
It can happen. You know, the other communities that I've been involved with are not Monday night hearings. We do a lot. Sometimes scheduling meetings can be an issue. I think part of the benefit of the company, for example, the recent school review, when we started out that process, the initial person we'd identified for the traffic review just wasn't available because he had conflicts, he had vacation, it just wasn't lining up. So we ended up selecting Mike to step into that process. So where there are issues with sort of timing of meetings, I think we have the depth of resources to take care of that. As far as I'm concerned, you know, in terms of multiple peer reviews, it can happen. It doesn't happen a whole lot. I've tended to be focused on two or three communities in the last couple of years, but it can happen.
So who typically would be coming to our meetings when we needed a peer review here? Would it be you, Merrick? Would it be Phil? Would it be...
What we would do and what we would encourage, I think, in say, in a Hopkinton situation is we'd like to have Phil playing a leadership role. So I would say more often than not, Phil would be the primary representative for the firm. If there was a situation, as there is now, for example, where we've got the school going on and we've got legacy going on, and Andy really wasn't, legacy's a large project, it was difficult for Andy to really combine into both, then I'm stepping into the school review more in that situation. So primarily Phil, but if there were a need, just in terms of workload, then I could step into a supplemental review that the town was trying to do, or if there were a specific issue that I needed to provide input on, then I would assist Phil.
Mr. Chairman,
yeah,
quick question.
Yep.
Even with now 3 years?
Yes.
More.
The company has, yes.
How would you rate yourself? How would you rate yourself? What do you do well? Where are some opportunities?
In terms of what we've done for the for the town? Well, I'll let Phil talk to the first 3 years, right? And then I can add.
Yeah, I think, you know, we've learned to communicate. We've learned how the board operates. I think we are good at communicating, you know, with where the projects are. You know, when I was involved, I was, you know, speaking to Elaine, you know, a couple times a month at least, offline. And, you know, if there was a project that was, not say a little bit out of control, but required a little more attention, then we were able to coordinate, you know, meetings with the applicant offline and such like that. I think in general we've tried to address the direction of the board. You know, I know that, and I'm very impressed with the outline format. No other town that I know of that I've worked in has the outline format, and you're very progressive in that. And so I don't know if I answered the question or not, but I think I'm pretty confident.
Subjective.
I don't think any situation is perfect. I think that we've done a good job in the last 6 months. There's been a lot going on. This is a busy town, and we've certainly worked in other communities where we've done bigger reviews and, you know, more expansive developments, but it tends to be a singular kind of review process. There's a lot between legacy, between the school, between the various different projects that we've seen. It's one of the busy communities that I've certainly been involved with, and we're also involved in the Concom. So I think all things considered, that I think we've done a very good job of being responsive, of turning things around. I think that when we don't always get things on time, and even when we've gotten things, say, on a Monday, we might not be able to get it back to you for a Tuesday evening, which is the cutoff, but we have been able to get it back in general for a Thursday. So I think we've tried to stay sensitive and responsive, not only in terms of turning things back, but in terms of handling costs and so forth. So, you know, not perfect. You know, it's very difficult to be perfect, but I think
to fess up, you know, I think the right turn issue over there in Lumber Street, I think that was one that was, I think we had a little miscommunication on that.
Starbucks as well? The Starbucks parking lot? Were you part of that?
Starbucks?
Yeah.
Unibank? I did the initial review for that project. I don't know what...
Well, my concern is how that parking issue came up.
They may not be aware.
Basically, turns out that Starbucks is not a typical coffee shop, so that the traffic estimates don't, they're in the handbook. Uh-oh. You know, we ran a surplus of 5 parking spots per the review, and Starbucks is a Wi-Fi hot spot. Plus they ended up
home office.
The home office. And we also found, I think it was 2 people that were using that as a commuter parking lot too. So so their Unibank is not very happy right now because there isn't enough parking.
Yeah.
And it was a tight spot, but quite frankly we thought when we approved it we had 5 extra. And I remember asking the applicant, and the applicant's and traffic engineer says, "Oh no, this is coffee shop." And, you know, it was...
Here's what the book says.
And, you know, by the book, yeah, they did it. But yeah. That would be one of my lessons learned. Okay, I think we're set. I think we know you guys pretty well. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Nice. Appreciate it. Coming in.
Sorry to surprise you.
It's a good surprise.
Yeah, it's good. Okay.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. See you.
Want to cover something real quick?
What?
Do you want to cover something real quick? You got a minute? 2?
Are they coming right in? John, why don't you start? Is she coming right back? Yeah. Okay. I guess we'll...
Shuts off.
Hi. Please sit. Have a seat.
Welcome, guys.
Thank you. So we brought, hopefully I brought enough. About a dozen.
Good.
So, since you mentioned the PowerPoint, except we probably out based on the layout of the room, we kind of just...
Okay, why don't you start off with kind of a quick presentation, and then we've got about 5 or 6 questions to
ask. Sure, absolutely. All right, good evening. My name's Dominic Rinaldi, and this is Sam Ofayadu, BSC Group. We're both senior project managers and senior associates with the company. I've been with BSC for about 15, I've got 16 years. And Sam has been there slightly longer. I won't age him or anything
about
like
20
that.
About 21 years.
Should we be awarded this peer review contract, generally speaking, I would be your day-to-day contact, the person that you would contact for when reviews came up and et cetera, and would distribute the workload appropriately. Sam is one of our senior traffic and transportation engineers. I am a civil site engineer. So briefly, a lot of this you got in the proposal about BSC Group. We're an integrated service provider. In-house civil traffic transportation, landscape architecture, planning, survey, which is what we started as, I guess, 51 years ago now. Environmental, we call it environmental permitting, it's really, you know, all wetlands and ecological science related permitting and planning, and structural engineering, more site-related structural engineering. We don't do buildings, we do a lot of bridge work, retaining walls. We've done a lot of steam tunnels and utility tunnels and things of that nature. Excuse me. As implied by having all those services, we really do try to take the multidisciplinary approach to all of our projects to the extent practicable. Some representative experience, I believe you've got a couple of peer reviews. We do peer reviews routinely for the Town of Foxborough Planning Board, as well as for both the Amesbury Planning Board and Amesbury Conservation Commission, as well as a number of other ones. Those are the two right now that we are doing a lot of regular work for. And in both cases, we tend to do work from planning and oftentimes all the way through construction, depending on what types of requirements the boards or commissions may place on the applicants. They may require a third-party inspection or observation firm, and a lot of times that for those types of projects, we stay on board. Our review process, it is a very collaborative review. We work, ultimately, you as the board have to make the decisions, right? We view our job as to help you to make the most educated and informed decision you can. We really work with you, work with town staff as applicable, work with the applicant directly if that's acceptable to you. Varies, my experience varies town to town, varies even project to project within a given town, based on whether it's the complexity or, let's say, the attitude of the applicants, perhaps, whether we work directly with them. We found, when possible, that some early interaction between us and the applicants and their design team is very effective tool to hash out really what we're looking for, what you're looking for, and start identifying items early in the process that could be a potential issue or that we'll really look for a lot of detailed information on. When we talk about, again, this pre-submittal meeting, and that coordination, if it's acceptable to the town, could last all the way through to the end of the review process. And again, as I said, if needed, construction period type work. We've reviewed, I want to say, every kind of project under the sun. It feels like we've done a lot of residential, commercial, big commercial, small commercial, multi-use projects. We've done a few solar arrays. Actually went through a weird period where we did a bunch of solar arrays. Everybody's been putting one on their town landfill all at once. So, our reviews range from full scope everything they're doing to, depending upon on what you're really looking for and need. Sometimes it's just a stormwater review or, compliance with the subdivision rules and rights type review. We've done 40Bs, we've done, as I said, large scale, small scale, run the gamut. Sort of try to get across, our goal is to really tailor it to what you need. Well, I'm sure is fairly consistent, does change from project to project. But in the end, as I said, our goal is to get you everything you need to make the most informed decision you can, because in the end, you end up having to live with whatever you decide. I mean, that's makes it sound like, we're planning an invasion of somewhere. I don't mean to make it sound like that, but it's something ultimately that you need to decide. We have a very green, I guess, sustainable approach to things. It's something we look for. It's something I know you look for. We try to find, I've been doing this for a while. There's a million ways to skin a cat. You can take a type of project, hand it to six different engineers, and get six very different designs. But what we do look for is opportunities. Not so much did they design it the way I would design it, because that's, unless I'm designing it, that's probably not what's going to happen. But are there opportunities where small, reasonable changes can be made that make it a better project, make it a more sustainable project, whether that's through stormwater or depending upon the site, you know, some sort of resilience planning, things of that nature. Those are the types of little things beyond the scope of, obviously, there's very much the, you know, the state has rules, laws, you have rules and regulations and bylaws. Those all have to be met. But can we do a little something here and there and make it a better project? Those are the things that we really look for in our reviews. So, that all being said, that's a quick overview of who we are, where we are. I'm sure you have questions. We'd love to make this as much a discussion as possible.
Lane, do you want to lead us through these discussions, please?
Sure. Can you take us through the typical peer review process from the time you get an application?
Yep. I mean, generally, so are you the day-to-day kind of, so would
nope.
you be the person
yeah,
who...
Jennifer.
Okay, so you would, yes, so I would get a call or an email or what have you from you, or, you know, in some towns, packages just show up at the office sometimes from somebody, and I give you a call and find out what's going on. Depending on the project, what you're looking for, I would gather, whether it's, if it's transportation stuff, SAM, LAs, whoever we may need, come up with a scope, pass the scope on you once the scope's approved. Generally, as I said, I found I don't know what your experience is on the sort of, whether it's pre-submittal, ideally sometimes it's pre-submittal, but even post-submittal, that sort of an initial meeting with the applicant and their engineers, I found if you're amenable to that, that can be a huge help. You know, we come in, whether that's ideally here with town staff as well, we sit down, they kind of walk us through the project. You know, we've already had some time to give it a quick once over, and we really talk about, you know, what's there, as I said, what we think we might need more information on, what we feel like could be an issue, and really start working those out before we actually put pen to paper and put something up. That gives them the opportunity, if they want to, if there's something that seems big that they might have to change, gives them that opportunity to change that before we've gone through the whole process of giving it a review and you know, getting it back and forth. Whether or not that happens, our review is thorough. Whoever, if there's transportation elements to it, for example, Sam will review that aspect of it. I'll review the civil site if there's landscape components that need to be reviewed or lighting, things of that nature. We have LAs. We bring those people in. We all do it. We compile it into one, you know, try to break it out as much as possible. It varies from project to project. Letter, provide a draft letter to you. Get some thoughts, make sure you understand what we are actually saying, clarify anything that needs to be said, and then, as I said, at your discretion, do you typically have your peer review folks come to the public hearing?
Usually.
Yeah. So that's, again, that varies. I've found from town to town, Inverary, yes, Foxborough, not so much, for example. So we would come to the public hearing, assuming you would want us to give a presentation, mm-hmm. a basic rendering. Would we touch on, you know, if I wrote a 14-page letter, I don't want to read a whole letter to you. I would touch on the big ticket items, the things that I think are really important, and be involved in the discussion.
Yeah, I think one aspect that we also do is the site visit. I mean, one of the first things we do is to go to the site and see what is the, especially from a traffic perspective, or the site access, the circulation, and the kind of obstacles that we need to be mindful of. So that is part of the whole process.
Yeah, it's part of the sort of the initial review. Typically, ideally, if you have that pre-hearing meeting, whatever you want to call it, with the applicant, it's kind of nice to sort of work the site visit into that meeting. Again, you have the applicant there. They can really point out what they're trying to do and clarify things that might not be that clear.
So when you get the bid package, what's your turnaround time for the final report to the board?
Let's give them a for instance.
I was just saying,
how about a 10-lot, 900-foot cul-de-sac subdivision?
That's a big road for 10 lots. I'm sorry, the first thing I thought of when you said that. I was like, wow, that's a big lot. I'm assuming it's something you can get done in a week. It's really not. You know, I mean, for the review part, I mean, obviously the meeting part, we have to work into everyone's schedule, but...
That would include stormwater.
Yeah.
Compliance with subdivision regs.
Yeah, it's...
Board has deadlines before meetings to get the information in.
Okay. Yeah, I think usually, I think that's what is critical, that at the very beginning, you just let us know what your timeline
is. That's the biggest
thing. And then we have the resources, and it might be a matter of pulling more people from one place or another to cover it.
Yeah.
Okay, let's do another
We're on the other side a lot, too. We deal with fire trolls all the time.
What about... Well, you walked into the place in Main Street. We have a new building right down the street here. I don't know if you noticed.
Close to the traffic light.
Okay. No, I guess you came in. You parked out behind us, right?
Yes.
Okay. You saw Bill's Pizza next door. We approved that a couple years ago.
Yeah.
Okay, it's a small commercial site plan review. A little bit of the parking lot. Mm-hmm. Most of the parking lot was existing, but new building, etc. Is that also that 1 week turnaround, or
worst case, that can be done in a shorter period. But a week is a nice.
I think that sometimes we also need to observe if there is some traffic pattern,
right.
The parking, etc. So that is really depend on what other components we have to.
I was just saying, if there's traffic, some of that will depend on.
It's really the time to go to the site and observe, but it's. The review itself doesn't take that long.
Yeah.
It's really the things leading to the review.
Okay, well, give me the last one. a new elementary school building on about 13 acres of kind of wetland.
So
51,000 square feet. I was going to say, full on traffic, everything that's involved in that. That's probably a few weeks
for the initial, and then. Then we get into the
supplemental obviously is always, you know, knock on wood. We're all sort of on the same page. Changes are made that are appropriate and correct, and it becomes, you know, it's a quick turnaround. There are others. I mean, we've done others that have acted on because you've had applicants that a board has said we want A, B, and C, and they've come back with B. Well, what about A and C? And then they come back with, you know, half C. And you come on, the willingness, and that's why, I mean, one of the things I very much try not to do, for a variety of reasons, is I don't want it to be an adversarial process. I know by nature it kind of is. Try to bring an attitude of, you know, we're all working together to try to see this happen, but obviously it has to happen in accordance with, you know, the town's requirements, whatever that entails.
Next question.
Do you have in-house lighting expertise? Lighting is very important to the board. Light lighting?
We do. We have, I'm an armchair expert at lighting, but we do have actual landscape architects that do that. We have landscape architects that can do, you can do full-on if you needed a lighting study for some reason that wasn't getting done and things of that nature. We do site lighting fairly routinely on our actual work, on our design side that our LAs perform and work with. Entities to get that done.
And what percentage of your clients are from the public sector?
Number or revenue. Number-wise, it's...
No, when you take clients for review or for
company-wide... For our total work.
Company-wide total work. Public versus private sector.
I think public...
Actual client numbers is probably 30%. Actual revenue is probably 50%.
Yeah.
You know, private jobs tend to be, or the public jobs a lot of times tend to be larger. We do a fair amount of work for MassDOT and towns and agencies with larger, longer-term projects. But client numbers, that's honestly a blind guess because we have so many small private clients that I probably forgot half of them.
And have you worked Hopkinton before?
I have not.
Your firm?
We've actually done work in Hopkinton.
I believe so.
I don't think we've ever done any private development work in
something VMC. But that would have been a long time ago. More from the wetland perspective. But yes, I'm not.
Yeah.
I can't remember as we sit here.
Yeah, we've probably done things like survey. We've started as a survey company and we've been around for 51 years. So we probably survey in just about every town, but it's survey.
Any changes to your fee schedule since you submitted the...
No, that's our fee schedule is pretty consistent for the most part.
Quick question. You said about 30% is public. How much, what kind of percentage do you do peer review for?
Of our total business, it's...
Oh, it's about the public line.
Yeah.
We're interested in public.
Yeah. I think we do. Well, we do peer review. We're doing one for Mass DOT now. Done reviews for Belmont.
Yeah.
We had a list of the ones that we have done, and it's
of our total public clients. Number wise, it's probably a pretty significant percentage that we are doing or have done peer reviews for.
Okay.
Revenue-wise, it's a fairly small percent.
And what? You talked about being the primary contact.
Yep.
What other municipalities are you currently working with? And I'm thinking of local here.
We have similar contracts with, like I said, Foxborough Plan Board. The interim one isn't so much a on-call contract as we are one of their, I guess, they have a handful of people that they use.
Was on retainer?
Yeah, I'm on retainer. It's just
designated.
It's not formed like we have more of something like this with Foxborough. Currently, Foxborough, I probably do 4 a year. Amesbury, the most was probably several years ago, maybe did 6 a year.
Probably
have
that number for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I said. Like Foxborough, and sometimes, Foxborough doesn't peer review everything. They maybe peer review 50% of what comes in. Amesbury, probably it's like 75% of what comes in, but it's Amesbury. It's not, it's a nice little rural, I don't want to call it rural, a nice little residential community. We do work as needed for Brockton. A lot of that is more on the transportation side.
Yeah.
David?
Just a quick question. So you'd be the project manager for Hopkinton, and Sammy will be like lead engineer. So you two personally, are you allocated to other projects as well? Like the number of projects, are you on a couple projects, or would this be your only project? Or?
No, we're both on other projects as well.
Okay.
Roughly
at any given time, maybe the number?
I probably have a very large number. I have a lot of very small projects.
Right, sure.
We have a on-call service contract with the City of Boston Parks and Recreation Department, where half of those are,
So it could even be like 6 to 12 or something, 6 to 12.
Yeah, so
clients.
Yeah.
Where Samuel would be.
Well, in my case, I mean, I look at all the traffic that comes through the group, and it's, and we also have other people in there, so
right.
I'll do the final review.
Sure.
To look at it. So we have about 3 or 4 projects, and some of them will be signal design, which it's really not more of sitting down to read too much other than to design it.
So 3 or 4.
And I mean, my projects and Sam's are largest, and two are largely supervising other people.
Sure.
You know, the day-to-day work is being done by other people, and we're the PMs on the job. And
sure, just one more follow-up. So as far as the bi-weekly or the every week meeting,
yep.
Who would be representing you guys at that meeting?
I would imagine that would be me.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we've got most of our questions answered. Thank you very much. Trying to figure out what we're going to do here, and
All right.
Let you know.
Thank you,
gentlemen. Oh, thank you.
Appreciate it very much.
No problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You just don't want to take it back.
Actually, that whole thing to say, that was a pretty good blind guess by me.
Yeah.
All right, thanks, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Susan wants this closed.
You keep the air conditioning in. Okay, now we have the hard decision. We've seen the three finalists. Why don't we start with Vincent? He'll give you the hard one. What are your impressions first?
Well, one of the questions I wanted to ask but didn't get to was, do they consider themselves a partner or a tool? And I kind of got my own little conclusion based on what they said. I felt McGuire came in and really seemed to want to be a partner. They really wanted to give us advice and information that could help us, whereas I thought this last group really, if you were going to cut your hand off, they would let you do it unless you asked them. That's the way I felt, and they even alluded to that on a few occasions where they said, well, we try to give us, you know, the best information we can, but ultimately it's your call. Obviously, we have an experience with Beta, and to get someone up to speed right now might be a little difficult based on the timelines we have, but now they're changing their project manager, which I don't know the gentleman. I kind of got the impression you guys do, and maybe you can give it up to speed. But you know, my impression was I felt for our needs. I just felt I like McGuire the best person. I know they don't have a lighting expert. It seems like I didn't know Beta didn't have a lighting expert, so apparently they could bring it in. So that was my impression.
Cliff?
I kind of agree with my brother here that it looks as though they were kind of trying to say, we do all the work, they'll collaborate with that, and ultimately it's our decision. The references seemed to be a little thin on their aspect.
Which group?
The last group that
okay.
we had, the BSC.
BSC.
Yeah. Okay. And I'm quite enamored with Beta in the when they say that they offer up and do a prelim that they don't charge for in the initial, and they've been working well, becoming more active with us, which kind of saves us a lot of time because they follow the project from beginning and stay involved throughout the process. As far as McGuire goes, it looks to me like they do want to be of great service, but I kind of question the fact that how much does that go into financial aspect of it as well. You know, like, are they going to limit themselves to keeping our budget down, or are they going to imply that we need to do X, Y, and Z and create a larger budget? So that kind of makes me wonder on that aspect.
Okay, let me go back to try to put some metrics to this. The way I rated your comments, Vincent, is that McGuire was one,
Beta was 2, and the last guy was number 3.
Correct.
Okay. So, going the same way, 1, Beta, 2, and 3.
Beta, McGuire.
And appointed.
And then
and
the last.
And the last.
Okay. Fran, you're next.
You just want my numbers, Mr. Chairman?
No, no. You're allowed. I want your rationale, and then I want your numbers.
You're allowed 64 seconds.
So one question I did have is making calls to the references. Have they been all completed? And
I think I was going to call, you know, the information you get from the references is very limited because they're all references that they include in their proposal, so you only hear good stuff. So I'll call the top, you know, companies' references, but you all only hear the good stuff. Okay.
So, you know, Beta's a known entity. You know what we're getting. I think Phil's experience, my experience with Phil over the past few years has been pretty good in general. I do like what how McGuire kind of positioned themselves with their level of experience across the board. I'm going to go McGuire number 1, Beta number 2, and then BSC number 3.
Yeah. Got enough room on that pad, Ken?
I'm going.
I also was impressed with McGuire. I know I came in a few minutes late. Hopefully I didn't miss too much. But the one gentleman who indicated that he would be the PM, I was impressed with him. The way he responded to, you know, everybody's answers, he seemed very open and honest. And I thought the whole team as a whole was good. We could tell who the real worker was there, and he wasn't afraid to speak up. I also enjoyed, seeing Phil back. I thought he always brought, a fresh perspective to these projects. He never had any hidden agenda. He was always, again, open and honest. And from what I could gather, he was always timely in getting his stuff put in, which I know you guys appreciate. So for me, McGuire and Beta kind of are a toss-up right now. So I don't know which one. If we were looking for new blood, this is maybe a good opportunity to do it, but I don't think Beta has done anything negative for me to say we shouldn't continue using their service. So with that said, I guess I would go Beta 1, McGuire 2, and BSC 3.
Okay. John?
I think I'm going to reiterate what others have said. BSC, kind of the mix of private, public, 50-50 across the board. Didn't seem like peer review was an important part of the business. Doing it, but not, it isn't a critical core part of their business. And that always worries me. Between Beta and McGuire, I think I agree that I like the project manager on McGuire. One of the things I look at is all the mistakes. Does Landry live in Huntington or does he live in Bellingham?
Okay. Bellingham.
Bellingham, because he says he listed on his thing as lives in town. I think he put in here, town resident or principal in charge. So that tells me they using the same form and didn't look at it. So if there's that, it's relatively obvious. So if I had a rank, it would be Beta, McGuire, and BSC.
Okay.
I would rank them the same way. Just to let you know, I thought BSC seemed a little bit small company, fly by the seat of the pants kind of stuff, and I wouldn't feel comfortable with them at all. The other two are very similar, both very professional. I like both project managers. I haven't had a lot of experience with Beta, but I'm really impressed with the way that Merrick ran the presentation and what I've seen with him in the past. I haven't worked with Phil at all, but so you have my numbers, and yep. I feel comfortable with either of the top two.
Ryan?
So let's get this out of the way. I would rank Beta 1, McGuire 2, BSC 3. This very impressed with McGuire. I liked the presentation. One thing that wasn't so much sold on was a small percentage of peer review is what he told us. And that's what we're looking for, is peer review. It was great to see Phil back. Was it Matt, I think, said? No, John. I don't remember. Darn it. Phil always brought, you know, a great perspective to the meeting. I thought that he brought a lot more than Andrew has brought over the last year, and maybe even more than Merrick has over the last few years. And with him being the person who's going to be representing Beta here in our meetings, I would look forward to that again. There's always the known versus the unknown, you know, and I would personally say I've never been unhappy with Beta's performance, with their peer review. They're very organized, very detailed, and I believe very timely. Do I think McGuire would be? I think so. Do I know it? I don't. The only thing that concerns me is Beta is priced so far above and beyond everyone else. You know, they counteracted that in their presentation, though. With the quality and how quickly they turn around, so they're not spending as much time. And then the last thing that I liked about Beta 2 is they're not dealing with the public, so there's never a conflict of interest. So that's why I rank Beta 1 over McGuire.
Jen?
Definitely BSC was 3. Mostly because I think I look at it from a perspective, and one of the big things I look for is their presentation skills and how they present themselves in public session before the board, and I thought he was awful. Like, I didn't think he was a good public speaker. I didn't think he was good presenting. To Cliff's question to the first group, I don't think a lay person would be able to understand a word he said. And so I just think he would be not good. Again, McGuire and Beta, I think, are neck and neck, and if it's not broke, why, you know, don't fix it. And so I think I'd give the edge to Beta just because I haven't had any issues with them. I've only been dealing with them since March. You know, I like Merrick. I've had no problems with him. You know, he's been responsive to me. You know, he does what I've asked or needed. I haven't really had an opportunity to work with Phil, but everything I hear, and I talked to Don McAdam a little bit today, knowing this was going to come up, and he likes Beta. He did tell me that he liked it better when Phil was there, so that's a plus for Concom. So, I mean, I guess I would go Beta, McGuire, and BSC.
Elaine?
Yeah, I agree with what's been said. I always liked Beta's pragmatic approach and trying to work with the board and move the projects along to resolve things. One of the things about McGuire, you know, they seem to know what they're doing, but their focus, I think, in looking at their proposal is more water and wastewater. We don't really have a lot of that. It's more the straight civil stormwater stuff. But, you know, that being said, I think they both could do it. And I remember, you know, before Beta, when we worked with FNT, we had a lot of complaints from applicants about peer reviews, about the quality and so forth, but I don't think we've ever had a complaint about Beta from anyone. So
that's good.
As far as the quality of work, so I think Beta would be number one for me, with McGuire a close second.
I think everything Ken? Has been said. No.
Ken.
I'm sorry, wait a sec. Kobe. You've listened to him.
I don't know if she's been paying attention.
Yeah, no, I agree. BSC was probably not my favorite. Maybe they're young, I don't know. Beta, yeah, I mean, even from my perspective, they've been always responsive to just my stuff. You know, come and get the materials, answer the simple questions that I have from the beginning. No problem.
They treat you with respect?
They treat me with respect, absolutely.
Okay, that's kind of what we're trying to ask.
Yeah, and I think McGuire would do the same thing, though.
Yeah.
And there's no reason not to.
And their billing, their invoices are prompt left it easy to understand.
The bills are very good.
Well, you know, everything laid out in the bills, what they charge for.
Well, I kind of echo with what most people have said, and my ranking is such, and I, number one, if it's really not broke with Beta, and quite frankly, I was on the board when we fired FST, and they made it into a business of creating more peer review stuff, I felt, you know, and you know, the reports were, they weren't working with people, et cetera. So that's kind of why we got rid of at that point. It's a lot easier if we don't change folks in the way, because we won't have to go through a learning experience, at least for us, and that's worth a little bit of something. I'm not 100% sure on the costing, because your table, which I really enjoyed the summary, had a range in it by people's names, and I didn't understand.
Well, that's what had a range.
And I don't quite understand that. Is it a person a category, and then they also have a name in that area?
I think it's the category. From looking at the proposals, it was that job
title
has that range.
Based on years of experience or right. Whatever you might
have. We don't have specific on the other individuals.
One of the questions we might want to go back to, one is to see where this proposal is, I'm going to say, relative to the current billing?
So I had sent you
yes,
the current fee in email, and I have copies of the email.
Current.
Somebody summarized?
Yes.
They weren't summarized, but Brian had asked that question, so
what
I had
this
told.
Is,
huh?
So,
they're only like about $10 off, I think, $15
off. So they've gone up a few bucks?
Yeah.
Through you, Mr. Chair, the point that Brian made, what Merrick said about the billing, that it's not purely hourly rate. It has a lot to do with the applicant and how well prepared they are, you know, which doesn't say a lot for it, you know what I mean?
I agree. I mean,
yeah.
What a review costs an awful lot is how well the applicant is in focusing in on doing a good job, whether he comes in with a scattered proposal or one
sure.
With 18 layers that you can't even read on a particular drawing.
Right.
I mean,
well,
it's
through the chair.
Yeah, go ahead.
That's why I purposely asked that question to McGuire was that, you know, do they base their, can they calculate their decision on what the project demands versus their hourly rate? Was to see how they would respond to that in correlation to what we were already dealing with Beta. We already know what we're dealing with Beta. And the two outstanding were, in my opinion, when I was reading that data, was McGuire and Beta. So
okay.
That's why I posed the question.
Okay. So it seems like we have a consensus that Beta will be offered the job. Where are we and what do you need to go further in this?
I don't think we need to call the references for Beta.
I don't think we do either.
So we can just do a contract with the town manager and sign that.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure. I think there might be an opportunity. You might want to do a little best and final on the fee aspect if you can.
Narrow the range?
Narrow the range.
Yes.
Spell out people.
Loyalty discount.
This is also, you know, we're talking pennies, but these pennies add up, especially coming from, where are they, Norwood?
Yes.
So, currently, they've been at 51 cents a mile for travel. Norwood's not next door. Everyone else who proposed to us is 51 cents a mile.
That's what the federal law is, I believe.
Yeah.
Beta's at 56 cents a mile. We're only talking 5 cents a mile, but you know, you're putting on how many miles?
I second the proposal.
Okay.
It's pennies, but it adds up to dollars.
So would it be appropriate for us to offer a motion to authorize Elaine and to negotiate the final contract at this point? Would that be the appropriate motion for tonight?
I'm happy with that.
Was that your motion?
A motion?
Seconded.
Okay, it's moved and seconded. We move forward with negotiating a new contract for 3 years, I guess?
Three years
with Beta, with an option to extend or whatever, I guess.
Whatever the terms are.
Why is our sheet only a 2 year?
I think what we say is a 2 year contract with an optional third year. So if you're not happy after 2 years, you can terminate at that point.
Okay. So further discussion on the motion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And can you call all three tomorrow and let them know where we're going?
Me? I can call them.
Well, can do it. Okay. Okay.
Who's the primary contact for the project?
Got it. Okay.
Let's hurry.
Let them down.
Is there any room in that contract negotiation?
2 years with the third option.
Yes, we can do that. Yep.
The only question, Elaine, that I would like to add into that is that because, what's his name, the guy that just came back?
Phil.
Now that Phil is back, I'm sure he's at a higher pay scale than what that was, and they had referred to that. So maybe we find out where that sits as well, because if he's going to be our representative, then...
The motion was to negotiate.
Right.
Yeah. So we want him listed instead of Andy Ogle here. Yep.
Elaine all over it.
Okay. Let's get some of this business done for the next 15 minutes before we have our hearing. There's a couple things. Let's start with the discussion regarding parking on sidewalks. John,
I was surprised when I have a situation off of Main Street with a truck at night, not related to anybody in the neighborhood, parking on the sidewalk overnight. And it appears in the town of Huntington, there is no prohibition of parking on a sidewalk, blocking a sidewalk with a car. And it seems that if we have an initiative to increase the amount of sidewalks, it seems strange that we wouldn't ban cars from parking on sidewalks, forcing people to go around them in the street. And in this case, you actually have to go farther into the street, because in this situation there was a truck and was part on the sidewalk, part on the street. So not only are you walking the street, you're walking 7 feet in the street. So one of the things is, not as part of the zoning requirement, but as town bylaw, is initiating a ban on parking on sidewalks. It just seems... I look through every town, and we also, you might want to touch on, we really don't have any traffic regulations in town in the bylaws.
Build off what John said, Mr. Chair.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just want to question the process. Or are we proposing that we write a letter to the selectmen suggesting
that or we take it on as a project? You know, I mean,
for Zach.
Well, I'm not sure it's a Zach, because it's not a zoning bylaw. But we as a board, or even as a group of 10 folks, can submit, you know, for 10 you could do it as 10 citizens, but I mean, as a board, we could also introduce a non-zoning bylaw if we thought was necessary. And I think, given their interest in sidewalks these days, I think there's nexus to me to see that we're not stepping on somebody else with it, you know.
Just a follow-up to the process, then the sort of second option would be to create this town bylaw ourselves and bring it before the town meeting?
Yeah, okay. Eventually, yeah. And, you know, eventually we'll have town council, you know, as part of that portion. Hopefully we can find a bylaw that's in some other town.
Every town.
one other point of discussion.
And then, you know, and we'll discuss, you know, what the fine would be for that. And, you know, we do have some kind of parking, because there's a parking clerk who works for the selectmen, and I think it's the assistant. So, you know, we issue a lot of parking tickets.
I'll find out.
I know there's been situations at, like, the high school where parking illegally for events.
EMC Park, right, or the state for state parks. Right. You know, they issue a lot of. I mean, it's not an insignificant revenue source.
It's a big revenue generator.
Yep.
Who would be the public safety committee that would deal with something like that? Do we have one?
Selectmen come as close that I could tell.
In Mass General Law, the selectmen are the ones that are charged with traffic rules and regulations. Now they could, you know, give that job to somebody else, but under Mass General Law, I believe it's the Board of Selectmen.
So, Ken, in the aspect of that, the traffic directors that we have in front of the school and the protected new elementary school, it's been said in meeting that they've been duly sworn,
yes.
So, who swore them in?
The selectmen create special policemen.
Okay.
You know, it's the same guys that are watching construction details a lot.
That's just the direct traffic. They can't write tickets.
Yeah, but it wasn't it said somewhere that you had to be a police officer?
I think that person that we're talking about, it's been made a special policeman.
Yes.
Okay.
And, you know, if you're a citizen of outstanding character or an ex-fireman, you can direct traffic details.
Retired fire.
Yeah. I knew a guy that used to be on the school committee at one time, ages ago, and he paid for his couple of vacations a year out of traffic detail. He was, you know, 65.
Was that Paul? Yeah. To the chair?
Yeah, go.
In addition to what John's suggestion about parking on sidewalks, I would like to also look at parking on bike lane, because I think that could be illegal as well, and I love other towns, you know, because they have bike lanes, as opposed to designated parking.
So how do we want to do this? John, you have the most...
I would be happy to run with it.
Okay, right now we're going to let John run with it, and when you're to the point where, between now and December time period...
Come back and something within.
Oh, good. You're going to come back. Thank you.
Yep.
Giving himself a deadline. This is good.
Yeah. Well, two meetings.
Okay. Well, we'll try to fit it in. Hopefully, we'll have some of these other big projects approved by all that. Second letter is, and we've got 10 more minutes still here. The letter to the Board of Selectmen regarding the safety issue on Wilson Street. The draft has been in your packet for the last two meetings. The only draft change that I think we might want to do is we might want to reference the map that, you know, we provided as part of the site plan decision, and kind of reference that in there, like see attached plan for the gas lights, something like that.
So the suggestion of the stone wall or some other area. That's the value you're referring to.
That's yes. Yeah.
Quick question about this draft, and I think I may have sent an email. If not, I think it was in my head to do it, and maybe we're not. It's not the right. We're not the people to be making suggestions to the Board of Selectmen about this. But where Roy has found someone, I think Roy has probably found someone who will put up these gas lights. And, you know, we talked about the gas lights in the last paragraph. Could we make sure, you know, suggest to the selectmen not only continuing the mitigation, but get in touch with Roy and maybe getting done sooner rather than later? Maybe it saves the town's cost.
Yeah, we can add something like that if you want, but I mean, I'm not sure that...
They may not want to hear from us.
I'm not sure that the contractor for... I mean, it really depends on where the land is that you're going to put them on.
I don't know.
Okay. I thought that last sentence said that, though. What you're saying, a little bit more specifically.
Yeah. Just trying to get it done at the same time so to save the town money.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I don't mind. We don't mind working closely with you. Mm-hmm. And so we're putting a 4-inch schedule 40 conduit through the easement and inside the 2-inch pipe through that, so that'll be easy enough to do. And the comment was, well, why does the planning board want these lights? I still think about it. Wouldn't it be a pleasant walk around your facility with ice cast lights? Because these guys are the
pipeline guys.
They're the pipeline guys. They have nothing to do with the LNG facility.
Right.
So why get them involved?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
They're saying, why would they want to do that? Well, think about how pleasant that would be.
Yeah. Good for you, Roy.
Okay. Or just that one change to reference the plan?
Yeah. Okay. Motion to send the letter.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. I think we got time for a performance bond in Form 10-K for Foxhollow.
Yes. So you voted this in the end of June, your meeting, to release the lots once the bond is in form acceptable to town council. So after several discussions and weeks of back and forth, it's finally in a form acceptable to town council. They have executed it, and so I just need your signature on the performance bond.
So we do not need vote?
You do not need to re-vote this. No, it's already been voted. And then this is the lot release. So I need at least 5 signatures here and at least 5 signatures here, preferably the same 5.
From the chair.
Yep.
Okay.
Thank
you. Stop.
What?
It stopped.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll go
refill
my water.
Could
I go as well?
Sure.
I need 5 signatures.
Fill me up.
Can I get you some water?
Well, I'm all set.
All right. Anybody need anything?
We're back in this room, huh?
We are one night only.
We have 5 here, yeah, so we're good.
We have 7 minutes before the hearing goes, so we're going to move on to a couple other things once we get a few members back.
Oh, I'm sorry.
They keep dropping like flies. You just left another one. One came back.
Are those all signed by whoever
Vincent to sign that one?
I have signed
one.
This one's Vincent.
Oh,
we need one more.
You wanted to get the same. Did you sign the other one?
You signed the other one that went.
Oh, then let's just get his signature and be done with it.
Yeah.
Or
David can sign because he signed this, so.
What do you need signed?
Send it back?
David?
Dave signed, you signed what?
Vincent didn't sign. Vincent signed
the other one, but not this one.
You think
he's
your amateur on
there? Yeah. So there's 6 on there then?
There's 6 on there.
Okay.
I grabbed him to sign an extra.
Okay.
See, I was smart. Go ahead.
Sounds good.
So you're happy?
Oh, nice.
Okay.
I was like, it's kind of a golf type of thing. Nice.
Let that go for a minute.
Shall we?
Yes.
Shall we approve some minutes?
Sure.
Let's see. Why don't we wait till we get? We do have enough.
5.
Yeah.
Yep. Majority.
Remember, these are the same minutes that were in the packet last week that we never got around to. So basically, entertain minutes for June 13th, 2016. Are there any comments, questions?
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Second. Ready for a vote? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Now the vote before us at this point is to approve the minutes for the 27th of June, 2016. Any comments, questions? Remember, Frank had said he liked both of them last time.
Yeah.
Yeah, Frank, we're thinking about you. Looking for a motion for the minutes on 26. Moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries.
The only thing I'm going to add happened to...
What?
I have planning board. I'm just going to
add sure.
Happened to...
Absolutely. Another thing for members of the board. You're going to be getting a request from Claire Wright to go look at some lights. And I'm kind of warning you now, because you're obviously going to want to look at them in the dark. The town is looking at changing over to LED streetlights throughout the town.
That was on my list of things. Is she sending out a request?
I don't know whether she's sending it out, but I'm just kind of warning you that you got to take a... They won't be as pretty as the gas lights, but I think one's at Center School, one's at Chamberlain Street, I think.
I actually can pull it up.
Chamberlain and Sanctuary Lane, I think.
They're existing now?
Yes, they have three LED sample lights installed.
So one at Cedar Street, four consecutive lights from Hopkins Drive past the post office. There are two different light types, all the same wattage. First two closest to the corner are one type of light, the next two are a different type of light. And then Ash Street, the first four lights from East Main. Again, the first two from East Main are one type, and the next two are a different type. All four are the same wattage.
Okay. And then there was one at Sanctuary, too, near Sanctuary?
Could you send that out to us?
I'm going to, but I didn't want to send it before today's meeting, so I didn't want you to think it was on tonight's agenda.
Yeah. Okay.
And are we supposed to just observe and provide our feedback? Or?
Yes. Yes.
Well, so we have them scheduled to come Monday. My question was going to be, we already have a 7:30 and 8 o'clock hearings. Is anybody okay with coming at 7 so they can come at 7?
What's a 7:30?
7:30 is Roy's master plan special permit.
What's it?
I have no objection to come early.
Well, the school should be knocked out in 15 minutes.
But because it's a sustainable grain committee and Dave Del Torio, so.
Let's try that at 7 if there's no serious objection, because we've got to give all the amount of time we can to the school. I don't want to get from there. Okay. So now we have, I believe, we're at 9 o'clock. And I think we're ready to... Oops, we're 2 minutes.
I'm good. Thank you.
Any other member comments, reports, liaisons, future agenda items? And then I think the time is pretty close to 9 o'clock, I think. So, basically, we've gotten everything out of the way at this point that we have to do other than this hearing. So you've got, 1 hour today. So that's...
Mr. Chair, just one quick administrative note.
Yep, yep.
I will not be here next week. I have a scheduled vacation. Okay. You'll probably vote then, but... Fine with that. You should have enough people to vote, correct?
I think so.
Yes. Are you the only one who's not going to be here next week?
I hope so. His friend's already out, so.
I changed it. So it's just a meeting.
No, you can't
vote. Oh, I can't vote on it. I know you put that in every week. I know it. Trust me. It's not going to change.
Okay.
So down to 8 without you, we're down to 7?
Okay, and we need 5. Let's reopen the continued public hearing for the Northeast, Northwest, and North Club Villages at Legacy Farms. This is an application for the Osmond Site Plan Review, Multi Homes of New England, and Legacy Farms. Okay, let's kind of summarize where we were at the end of last time and what's changed, and I think first thing I see in my outline that I think we're close to, Mark, is the construction management plan.
Mm-hmm. So, Mr. Chairman, last Monday we spent a great deal of time going through all of the comments we've received to date on the construction management plan, and then also comments that we received as we went page by page from each of the board members. We went back after the meeting and Our team went through our notes, and we think we captured all of the comments that we heard. And since the last meeting, we resubmitted to the board a revised, updated construction management plan. I think the board, you should have got that on last Wednesday from John's office, with a little summary of the updates we made to the plan that I think incorporated all of their comments. We hope incorporated and resolved all of their comments and addressed all of their comments. And then an updated construction plan that is sort of a latest and greatest document.
I think the key point that was the maximum amount of open area, and I think you reduced it from the mid-50s to 42 acres at this point.
That's right.
And you didn't change any of the wording. I thought we were going to weasel word it one way or the other, but I don't know where the board members, is 42 more acceptable at this point?
Absolutely.
So I think I'm seeing consensus that we're kind of done with the construction management plan at this point. Okay?
Okay.
So we'll check that one off. Okay. We'll get back to 5 as the last one. There's a couple that we hadn't fully checked off, which was item L, which is, I'm trying to figure out where that is.
Four L, or?
Well, it would be 5.
5L, traffic analysis.
5L, traffic analysis. I'm not sure what else we need to do at this point.
It just may not be checked off because I wasn't sure, so if you're fine with it, I'm happy to check it off.
I think that we basically found that the traffic studies were consistent within the master plan special permit, and nothing was terribly out of bounds with where we are on the traffic.
Was it the discussion about the speed through that intersection? Was that what it was related to?
Mr. Chairman,
yeah.
If I may?
Yeah, go ahead.
I remember having discussions about the adequacy of the intersections of some of the villages onto the defined road.
Yes.
North, and we went back to VHB and had them relook at each of the intersections, and they wrote a memo reconfirming that, in their expert opinion, that the intersections were still suitable, adequate,
yep.
Appropriate.
I think part of this is also, particularly the future studies. When we wrote the master plan, we kind of envisioned that with each site plan review, you get another bite at the apple, and just because you have more history that goes with it at that point. Now, we're kind of approving, I'm going to say, 2/3 of the north side all at one point, and believe the master plan special permit really just talks about, you know, where it is. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, one of the things VHP did a study on in changing the 200,000 square foot commercial.
Right. Can you just speak up just a little?
Sure.
One of the things VHP did an analysis on was when we changed the 200,000 square feet of commercial up in the north quadrant to 180 units of age restricted, it greatly reduced the traffic, future traffic. So if anything, we're going to be significantly under the amount of traffic that was originally anticipated for that location.
Yeah. Okay. I'm trying to think of other things that kind of go with traffic analysis. At one point we were talking about stop signs on Wilson and Legacy North.
Actually, just to give more of an update, so this past Friday, we finished installing all the signs on Raffney Road,
a new Wilson Street sign, new stop signs, a new Cedar Street sub sign, Cedar Street street sign on Route 85, and some left turn lane only signs. All the new signs have been put in, all the new paving has been completed on Route 85, and the new lines are going down tomorrow. So by tomorrow evening, or worst case, next morning, we'll have a line down the middle of Rafferty Road. New signs are in. We'll have new lane lines on Route 85, so it'll be all complete.
And I think we have fog lines on Rafferty, or old Rafferty.
I don't think the plan called for fog lines.
We discussed that in the meeting and wanted to have those.
I thought we did.
It's before me, so I have to.
We have to go look at the hook. I thought I remember fog lines for making it a little narrower. That's what I remember, right? But you know, I might be losing it.
How would I find that out? I'll get them out there tomorrow. Now we could put a fog line side with the sidewalk. I'm concerned if you do it on both sides, you're going to narrow that road too.
Well, I think that was the discussion. Is we wanted to kind of narrow. Maybe Kobe remembers. Fog lines, white lines on Rafferty Road. When we had that discussion, didn't we agree to fog lines on that?
I believe so. Yeah.
Okay, so you in the morning you can look up the minutes real quick for that. We'll do whatever we decided to do at that meeting, as far as I'm concerned.
If I could find that.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, can you educate me the difference between fog lines? Is that like a pipeline?
No,
it's much narrower.
It's a white line right on the shoulder.
Okay.
And
looks the same.
Yeah, it looks the same. A bike lane would give you about a 4 or 5 foot width.
Right.
Yeah, the whole concept. Think about it this way: the road is foggy at night. Yep. You're driving, and you can watch that line on your right shoulder going down. That's why they call it a fog line. Typically, it's anywhere from 6 inches to a foot away from the shoulder, sometimes more.
Thank you.
Anyone else remember that discussion?
I do. I remember hearing something about it.
We did it.
I remember having the discussion. I remember we voted to do the fog lines.
I thought we did too. So it'll be clear in the minutes, I'm sure. Okay. So basically, we're pretty well set at this point.
Did Roy answer the question about the stop sign? Whether they were going to on Legacy Farms North or Wilson?
So to clarify that, because I remember this quite clearly, the neighbors on Wilson down near, what's that street?
Kruger.
Yeah.
They were concerned about traffic coming down Legacy and taking right onto Wilson. And the assessment of the board at the time, this board was, for now, right now there's a stop sign at the end of Legacy, there's a stop sign at the end of what is now Rafferty. So you can't go through. Wilson does go through at the moment. The concept was, eventually, do you want to change that so Legacy is the one going through, and do you want to put the stop signs on Wilson? The concept was, that's yet to be determined. The other thought was, by this board 7 years ago, if for some reason down the road it appears to be too much traffic going from Legacy down to Wilson, to the right, you put a no right-hand turn sign there. But that was to be determined in the future.
Yeah. I think today with Waves and Google Maps, people are going to go where the application tells you to go. I mean, it's such a change these days. Okay, other things on traffic issues? So basically, I think what you just told us and gave us the update is after like Monday or Tuesday we could schedule a ribbon cutting on Legacy North and open it up. Or is there still other work going down?
Here's my concern. To get to David's point, the grass on the road, all the grass on the north side needs to be touched up this fall. They see the spring, but as we all know, we've had a drought summer.
Yep.
So the grass is not taken the way it should. So that really needs to be received. Hesitant to have cars driving on it while we're trying to do that. At the same time, we've got Eversource still continuing to put wires in the road.
Okay.
So I think it'd be nice if we could stay close to a little bit longer.
Okay. I think we want a ribbon cutting, though.
Just a quick question?
Yeah.
Through you, Mr. Chair. Is there scheduled maintenance for mowing that strip?
And it will be this fall, for sure.
It'll start in the fall. How about Legacy South? Is it?
That's cut every week.
Okay. It's just the cutting, though. There's no other kinds of... oh, there is? Okay.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
Just a question for personal education. Is there a timing for the change of name of Rafferty to Legacy?
The vote by the Selectmen was the name should be changed when the road is opened.
So when the road is open?
So whatever that is.
Okay.
Okay.
Maybe a month from now. We have all the new signs.
Okay. So we'll unveil a sign and cut the ribbon.
Should we cover it, the sign, and then unveil it?
Okay. The next, yeah, and we'll take all the heat for that one. Community impacts and mitigation. I think when I talked to Elaine, Roy is pretty well up to speed on the master plan special permit and the host community agreement stuff. I think there was an extension being asked on a couple of payments based on Leslie Road North being later than normal and expected. So I think from that standpoint, I think we're there. The only other one would be the remaining section of sidewalk on East Main Street.
It's like we're thinking the same things.
Well, that's good.
Well, actually, I'm glad you brought that up. We wanted to go to the Conservation Commission soon because I walked that whole stretch with John Westerling a while back, and John feels that we should be picture the fog line on East Main Street. Inside the fog line, putting a berm the whole length of the road, the other about 5 or 6 inches, and from the berm into the current guardrail would be the sidewalk. It would keep us off the Roger Messick property, which make life a lot less complicated. It'll save cutting down hundreds and hundreds of trees. And the only thing we'd have to do is once we get down to the so-called athletic field parcel, there's probably about 100 feet, of maybe 150 feet of guardrail that we'd have to move back about 18 inches. Other than that, it fits perfectly.
That sounds like a great solution.
Yeah. So sure. If this board is okay with that, we will have a flame engineer submit that to the CONCOM in parallel, bring that to you.
Okay. Roy,
could I ask you to sit up the chair?
Sure.
That air conditioning is not heavy.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Do you have a time frame on that, Roy?
Now that I sense the permits, we'll get out right away. This fall.
Okay.
At least with the CONCOM.
And that brings pretty much up to speed with a lot of it. The athletic parcel got conveyed to town yet, or
no?
No,
we're going to do that right away. We're going to give you both parcels.
Okay.
Matter of fact, maybe if not this week, next week for sure. The only thing we're waiting on is get the deed drafted.
Okay.
Everything else is done.
Okay.
Does that fall into the purview of Park and Rec?
That falls into the purview of us no longer paying property taxes.
Nothing always seems in such a hurry.
Okay.
It's only been 10 years.
Okay, let's now go through a brief discussion on the, which is item 5A, and maybe you, John, you can kind of take us through each village really quick, and we'll kind of check this all off tonight, and I think most of us are pretty comfortable with where we're at, but this is kind of the last chance to ask a lot of the questions.
I'd be glad to walk through that, if that's okay.
Sure.
Much of this, I believe, has been covered in our discussions throughout the process, not necessarily on a village-by-village basis, but as an overall kind of cohesive land plan. While you're setting up, though, Matt, I will say that we did spend 5, 6, or 7 meetings with the design review board, going through the villages in a very detailed manner. We actually did go through each of the villages one by one, and ultimately we ended up getting, I think the board ended up getting a letter from the design review board
sort of approving or signing off on the latest design that we had come up with to address all of their comments. So you should have that in your files.
Okay.
So I just don't want to tread over ground we've already covered. If you had specific questions on particular villages, I could run through.
Could you just bring that over towards you a little bit more so we can all see?
I'm sorry. Yeah. Get some new easels.
I don't know where they came
pretty
from.
Pretty fancy.
Since this
is one of our last times to go over this, I don't mind you treading on some things again, okay. Just so we're totally
sure.
Let's kind of try to go through the outline because that was pretty comprehensive. First of all, Beta, I think you guys are done with comments on Legacy North.
Yeah, I think so. All we're going to do, just as a matter of process, is just kind of show a final letter. I think just responding to the comments and just basically closing them out.
But everything is taken
yep.
care of at this point. Okay. Go.
Okay. All right. So overall, we have 425 units on the entire set of three villages. We're calling this the Northeast Village. This would be the North Club Village. The North Club Village has 103 units. The Northeast Village, 219 units. And the Northwest Village has 103 units. So that's a total of 425. Of those 425, we're looking at 201 simplex, single-family detached units, and 224 attached duplex units. Those are spread throughout each of the three villages. They tend to be clustered together in groupings of duplexes and then groupings of simplexes. We've discussed the various pros for laying out the site that way. In terms of the layout for the site, those villages are all accessed by entries right off Legacy Farms Road North. So both the North Club Village and the Northwest Village are accessed by two entries there. The Northeast Village has a series of four different access points that get you into those different neighborhoods. We've spent a lot of time through the Design Review Board and through the Planning Board trying to create distinct neighborhood identities within each of these villages. And those further break down these three main villages into five total groupings, which are highlighted by these different colored bubbles here. So those don't have any bearing on road names or unit counts or anything like that. These are just different enclaves within the overall project where we've tried to create distinct character in each of these villages by changing the street tree palette, the shrubs we use, the different sign types, light types, fencing types that will create that identity throughout these different neighborhoods. The building designs, types, and locations, we've described those and provided floor plans and renderings on what those different unit types are. We've discussed that these will be, people will have choices in which home they select to build on these various sites, but they're selecting from multiple floor plans, seven for each unit type, multiple facade treatments, so there'll be a lot of opportunity to create variety within the architecture as well. And that'll be kind of on an individualized basis with each homeowner. The landscaping and screening, we've taken pretty aggressive approach to screening Legacy Farms Road North. The views to and from the homes along those roadways, both by pulling the development away from the road more so than it was on the master plan special permit, and also creating berm areas along those roadways and a significant amount of proposed vegetation that will augment the street trees that were already proposed for along Legacy Farms Road North, which is augmenting several pockets of existing vegetation that we're going to be maintaining
particularly along the entrance from Franklin Street. This is all a big swath of existing vegetation that we'll need. So those are kind of buffering treatments to and from Legacy Farms Road North. We've also provided significant buffering and screening between rows of homes within the villages. We've provided detailed plans that have been submitted, but this just enlarges those areas. You can see the screening a little bit better between the backs of units that provides that visual relief. Stormwater management. In each of the villages, you can see where we're collecting in bioretention areas. We can get into greater detail in that, but essentially the water from the roof line in towards the road drains into the street, from the roof line back, pitches off into the landscaped areas behind homes. And then where we need to collect, you can see the basins and stormwater areas that CONCOM has signed off on. We've been through the entire process with the Conservation Commission on our stormwater management design, and it has been fully reviewed by the peer reviewer as well. The road design. From an overall standpoint, we've talked at length about hammerheads versus cul-de-sacs. We've eliminated all of the hammerheads in favor of providing cul-de-sacs at the terminations of any of our roads. We did have a cul-de-sac in this location here. We made a through connection so that was eliminating some additional pavement in that area. We provided a cul-de-sac in this location, and we've really eliminated all the straight sections of road that were on the original plan by providing some curvier streets in the North Club Village. So we feel that that was a big improvement, and that came out of this process, collaborating with yourselves and the design review board. The lighting I've touched on is distinct for each of those five neighborhoods. As I mentioned, there are five different types of lights that we're looking at. And we've described the Hillview Neighborhood Village as having wood post with a gooseneck fixture. The Eastwood Acres neighborhood would have wood post with a decorative ornamental fixture, white painted white. We'd be using that same light type at the Oakland neighborhood. Those two are linked here. They're sort of subcategories of a larger neighborhood, so they're both utilizing the same light. And then in the Ridgecrest neighborhood, more of a black ornamental fixture. And then in the Hallmark Heights neighborhood, still in the black ornamental, but a different, more of a lantern-style head on it. The lighting is primarily provided at intersections for wayfinding. They're also at our pocket parks and at various locations along the roads, but they're not meant to light it up like Broadway. It's really a wayfinding mechanism that's going to help people identify where their turn is, where the end of a road is. So just to really provide that wayfinding. Signage, we are proposing street signs that also have their own neighborhood identity based on what village they're in. So those street signs are shown as either a cedar post, as in the Hillview neighborhood. In the East Acres neighborhood, they will be integral with the street lights themselves. In the Oakland neighborhood, we're using that same motif. The Ridgecrest neighborhood, we're also providing the street sign on the light post. And similarly in the Hallmark Heights neighborhood, street sign on the light post. Resident amenities. We've discussed, obviously, one of the biggest amenities associated with this development is the trail network. associated with the open space and the open space itself. Discussed the trail network in the past, and I think we've come to some obvious consensus. I think we've reached agreement that the trail network plan shown here has met the needs of the master plan special permit and provided access into and out of these neighborhoods as well as around them to surrounding trails that are adjacent to the site. So we think that's one of the strongest amenities that we have here. We're also providing a tot lot for the residents here, which is located central to both neighborhoods, to all three. Just to show you the enlargement there, this would be the wood fiber play surface, picnic tables, benches, with a path that connects up to the main walkway up Legacy Park Road north. So we think that'll be a nice amenity for families to utilize that live in this area. So those are, I believe, all of the bullet items for the various villages. If you had any questions, I'm certainly glad to answer.
I've got a couple of questions.
Sure.
Let's talk about sewer pump stations.
Okay.
We've got two of them, I believe, or are there three?
There's two.
Two.
There's one up in the northeast village.
One right here.
Yep. Yep. Down there
and one right here.
Northwest, okay. And then there's a...
Are they fenced?
Yes,
they are.
So they do have a fence, so they're lockable.
Yes.
And they're landscaped? I don't remember seeing them.
They are.
There's some screening that we
show
put
you
around
some.
Them on the landscape.
Okay.
So they've got some, you know, 6 to 7 trees around them that provide some buffer. Okay.
So I think that's something that still needs to be added on the south side. As we clean up. Okay. Other questions for our members?
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
I have a question about the street signs and the ability for them to reflect and light up. I've never been to Legacy South in the dark, but does anybody know anything about that? I know we have on one of our roads, Saddle Hill Road, our street lights don't reflect. It's really hard to find in the dark, find a street.
You know, it's a hard balance because you've got some people who want more light and you've got other people who don't. Originally, when we installed the lights at both ends of Legacy and in the circle,
yeah,
people complained that they weren't bright enough. So we changed all the bulbs because it was a little dark.
Actually, I was just talking about the reflectability of the signs. When
signs.
The car headlights hit them?
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, of course, all the street signs are reflective.
Okay.
That's more of a question to you all.
Yeah, the only thing we'd be changing about the street signs would be like the background color, which doesn't typically reflect anyway. It's just white lettering.
Okay.
So we'd be... making sure that the contrast on those meets MBTC.
Some night I'll go test Legacy South.
So. Right.
And this is a little different than, I'll say, a subdivision road.
Correct.
Because,
correct.
You know, that's the private aspect of it,
yep,
so
sure.
It's different.
Sure.
Exactly. There seems to be such a uniformity on the other signs that it's almost getting to be, I guess,
boring.
They're trying boring, yes. That's a very nice way to put it. But and efficient, I guess, maybe.
So, you know, we're looking at a dark background color for the sign, but the letters themselves would be white.
We typically put the street sign next to near the street light.
Lights it up.
Would that be white reflective paint, or is that, I mean, tape, or is that the painted on aspect?
We'd have to check on that. I think typically the paint you use, I think, can be reflective.
Wouldn't it be?
I don't think it needs
to
be a decal necessarily. But,
yeah. We can add that to the detail.
Thank you.
That's fine.
Thank you. I mean, I think that would take care of all reflection and lighting.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Okay. My next question has to do with bedroom count. Do we have that summarized in the table somewhere?
In the application material.
And I assume we have exactly the number of bedrooms that are allowed on the north side?
1,943 for the whole project.
Yeah.
Give or take zero.
And that's exactly where we're at.
That's where we are.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, did they touch on the stormwater management?
Maybe I pulled that up.
Where they touched on that a little bit, partly Beta had no further comments on that, so technically it's okay, but you can have them show where the ponds are.
Yeah, I'd like to just kind of just double check on that.
Sure. John, I don't know if you want to jump in here, but you can see these darker green areas.
Has bedrooms in it.
Got it.
That we confirmed are accurate.
So these here, they should meet that. Along here,
special credit too.
Back here. So those handle the North Club and the Northwest Village. And then we've got it back here. This is a bioswale. Got one here. That's actually part of the Legacy Farms Road North construction. And then back here. So they're typically between the homes and the wooded areas for the most part.
Okay.
There's like maybe seven or eight of them.
Six correct.
Or seven, somewhere around there, right?
Yep.
And Beta says that's sufficient.
Right? Yep.
Mr. Chairman, if I can ask,
go ahead.
Can you speak to the street lighting again? You mentioned that it's not actually going to light up the street. Its primary goal is to give people the ability to navigate the area. Is it a low-wattage LED? Is it a low-wattage standard incandescent? Or?
Yeah, they're 12-foot poles. These aren't 30-foot parking lot poles. They're not typical highway lighting. They're very pedestrian-oriented lights. And what I meant by that was we're not trying to light up at 1 foot candle the entire roadway length. We're trying to provide light at intersections, at the end of cul-de-sacs, and places where people would need to make a turn so that they can see where.
Okay. So it won't light the sidewalks or anything?
That's not the intention.
Okay.
Yeah. But just
more of wayfinding and safety.
Mr. Chair?
To add to that, wouldn't end of driveway lights and all that other stuff give more illumination if families needed that, or is that part of that?
What's not part of that is the lights that people have in their own homes. There's a light on each garage that will cast light outward towards the street. And these homes are only 20, 25 feet back from the edge of the road. So those are providing kind of an ambient background light that will light up some of that sidewalk as well. So there's really not much of a need for more beyond that.
I mean, our typical subdivisions, we have not approved streetlights in ages here. I mean, right. It's...
No, I was just trying
It was about 15, 20 years ago, the Selectmen actually took out about half the streetlights in town.
I think somebody having a lamppost at the end of their street or a house.
Yeah, but mostly these condos don't have lampposts at the end of the drive, though. I don't remember seeing any of them.
No, they have as Matt described, a wall-mounted lantern
on the garage.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
Part of Vinny's question that wasn't answered is, are they LEDs? Are they incandescent? Are they low wattage? I mean, I'm going to guess that they're low wattage because you're not lighting up the street, but are they incandescent lights? Are they LED lights?
No, we talked about this at length with the design review board, and I think we landed on LEDs, but using the warmer color so that it's not that electric blue kind of light. So the spec on them is going to provide it in the warmer range so that we don't have that sort of hospital look to it.
Is that difference in south?
Yes.
It might be different. Okay.
The south are metal halide.
Halogen?
Metal halide.
Metal
halide.
Thank you.
The lights in the villages that Poulteen installed, I think, as Roy mentioned, I think you switched to LED at your entrance in the roundabout.
They did. But they will all be...
And there's even a different lights in the apartment complex, too.
Yeah.
But they all will be LED.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm not sure I noticed. I don't think the south part from the Poulteen part is overlit. The apartment complex is fairly bright. Brighter than I thought. We thought was needed, though. Its apartment complexes are usually a little bit brighter than individual homes, I think. But they turned out to be a little bit more than.
I remember talking about the apartment complexes and how bright the lights. I think it was the lights in the stairwells were, and you could see them from the end of.
Oh, that's right. You know, the stairwells were the worst.
You could see them from the end of Legacy Farm Road when you're coming down from Clinton.
Yeah.
Okay, where are we?
We're on Northeast Village.
Well, yeah. We just did all the villages.
We went through all the villages.
Yeah, okay, all right, so they were all included.
I went through other lists, basically, yep. but for all the villages at once.
Yep.
All
right.
I hope that's okay.
So, does anyone have other questions about the villages, stormwater, curbing, sidewalk, what?
We had brought up at our last one of the meetings before about a natural sidewalking versus a curbed sidewalking. I think you remember, Roy, that we were discussing.
I believe.
It's going to stay the way it is.
Okay, that's right. So I just wanted to make sure that that was okay with you being.
I'm not okay with it, but I'm okay with it.
Thank you.
Okay. So I'm going to check all those stuff off. So we are now getting to the very end. Item 6, which is public comment. you're happy today?
I appreciate Pulte, Mark, and Reed, and this crew working with our families with the items that we came to agreement on. Mm-hmm.
And we did call that out in the draft agreement, too. Okay. See no other public comment.
I think Andy's letter was fairly clean, and I think the important discussion has been had over the months between February and June, which is when all of the sort of operational landscaping screening discussions were had, and that to me was the more difficult discussion.
Okay, at this point, does anyone know of any plan modifications that need to be done for us to approve a clean report? I'm not hearing anything from Beta. I think we got it all set up at this point. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any outstanding action items that anyone remembers that we might have asked about that we didn't get an answer back to?
Remember when we talked about previous sidewalking and how that's being done cleaning. We found out applicably through the school that they recommend the sidewalk be swept every year and it vacuumed every year, not
That's a good question. We have a stormwater maintenance program as part of this. Are the sidewalks within the Pulte development the poorest asphalt?
No, they're not.
They're not, so they're just normal asphalt.
Correct.
Okay, so you haven't taken credit of that. The question about in our school debate is because they're doing poor stuff like...
Does
anyone remember on Main Road, did they take credit for that in the stormwater of using the porous asphalt?
I think they would have. We'd have to check that.
I can tell you VHB did.
They took credit for that. So basically, hopefully, the stormwater thing we approved for maintenance, which will be the town's responsibility, is the things have to be vacuumed like once a year.
Ideally, you'd like to vacuum it probably April, May, after you've had a winter where you may have had sand on it.
But again, what they inferred at through the school engineering was that, Beta, you were there, I believe, was that annually it would be done, but it's almost impossible to get it back to 100% over a certain amount of period, and it decreases as it goes. So there is a time, a life expectancy of that pervious sidewalk as silt and stuff builds up in it. And so they said that it probably has a lifespan of about 15 years, with an average of a regular sidewalk, I presume. Is that correct?
Well,
yeah, I mean, it certainly planning from 10 to 20 years is sort of a typical lifeline depending on what you're dealing with. I think for the legacy development, if that were happening, and we'd have to check the road to look at this, but the way the drainage works, it automatically ends up in a bio-infiltration or a retention basin, even if it was running off. So there's still the opportunity to sort of re-infiltrate and get it into a wetland, even if it's...
Okay, to that point, though, it was brought up that it wasn't fundamentally designed for runoff on that aspect. Am I correct?
Are we talking about the school now? Or?
Comparison of the sidewalk that runs along...
Cliff, I think this is a little bit beyond where we need to go for this approval tonight. If anything, it's on the Legacy North, in which the town has got to take up...
I agree.
Okay, then let's try to get through the draft decision then. Conditions of approval is the next item. We have a draft decision in front of everyone. Let me start off with planning board members. When you read through it, did you see anything that you think might be missing that we have in here? Because Jennifer wrote it, and Roy wrote it, I guess, they don't think that's missing anything.
Well, we filled in the pertinent information that Jennifer did the draft.
I think Elaine looked at it as well.
We took Elaine's draft, too.
Yeah, and I added a couple of paragraphs over the last week.
That's in here.
That's in here from what you saw. It's different than what we looked at last week. The conditions, basically, we've got our general, our three, actually five decision criterias, which just starts on page 2, and then we've gone through every criteria with different conditions that allow us to meet those criteria or mitigate them. I think we even got people's names spelled right now. I'm not seeing too much of...
Cliff, do you think we can turn the AC back on? Or?
Sure.
Just
couldn't hear anything.
Thank you. It's hot down this end.
Next meeting, you're gonna have to run and get that seat over
there. No kidding. I think I was put here for a reason, though.
Okay.
It's amazing.
Information. Okay. Any further public comment based on where we are?
Mr. Chairman, I did have one question in terms of the appendix.
Okay.
They're not attached here, so I'm assuming that they're all in order.
They were attached at the last copy you got, so I didn't think they had to damage.
You can print out another 100 pages for
each? No. But what is your question?
You got the construction management plan, and then you got a bunch of plans that get attached to it, and drawings, and...
There's an architectural submission that's an important attachment.
I've got them right here. If you'd like.
No, they don't seem to be all referenced necessarily. Because I didn't find them in the quick glance.
Oh my gosh!
I went through and double checked, but I feel. Did you see them? Yeah. See, B E A is the construction plan.
Correct.
Right. B is in second floor. Architectural letter. I'm sure they're in.
I have C and D here. Yeah, but...
No, I'm not in reference.
Oh, in the reference.
Page 7, you got a font change, I think. That's kind of nitpicking it.
Could I ask something with regards to the 42 acres and a timeline? Was there a timeline booked on that, or no, or yes? Or?
No.
No.
We didn't change any of the wording that was in the previous drafts. That's a number we can live with.
Okay.
All times.
I have no objection, but I just wanted to bring it up.
Appendix C and D.
So appendix C is in there.
D.
C, yeah, six is C is in six in the middle.
Yep.
Yeah. And D is in page two under paragraph seven. It's the site plans that are the approved site plans.
Jumped around a little bit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
We're all there.
Thank you.
Well, other than the fact that we promised Frank, I don't know.
That's why I said what I said last week. Don't make promises in a public meeting.
You can't vote.
I mean, either way, you're going to lose David next week, so you're going to lose somebody one way or the other.
You're sitting here. No offense, Frank.
When we talked to Frank, it didn't sound like he had any burning issues. I mean, that's just an assumption on my part, but I didn't
know. No, he didn't have any burning issues. He just wanted to be a part of the decision because he had worked on it for so long.
Yeah. Right.
We're live, right? We're live?
Yep.
No.
So,
we're texting him now to find out if he has any objection.
That's a violation of the open meeting.
Oh, you can't. Okay. All right. Well, we're not doing that then. excuse me for that.
Months.
Ken, maybe you make
talk.
7 years.
Your call, man.
Well, what do people feel? Should we entertain a motion to? Let's see. The motion would be to approve the site plan review and find that it meets the criteria with the following conditions.
Conditions as outlined in the draft decision.
So moved. I'll get the ball.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion. Yes.
I know we told Frank that we would postpone it for him, but I hate to do the and I respect that. But I would hate to hold this up just for the vote. We've approved everything. Frank is on board with it. I know he wants to be a part of the decision. But to make these people come back another week, just so that he can vote and say yes, just doesn't seem right or logical. It's emotional.
And the other part of that is that next week we need all the time in the world for our school friends.
I think it's a go for vote.
Okay, I believe it's a move and it's a second. Is there further discussion?
You can.
Other than I don't like it, I don't think it's fair. We basically set it up public, the video that we would wait, and it's a 2-minute vote.
Duly noted.
I hate to make them come back, but they were sitting here when it was said. It's not like we're hitting them with it below the belt. I don't know if they expected us to vote tonight. I don't know.
I think it's just the logistics of it.
Yeah.
I mean, we would like to have Frank here. I was willing to sacrifice. I'm not here next week, so I was willing to sacrifice that because he's been on the project longer than me. But, I mean, to Jen's point, you can't kind of schedule things that way. You have to take them as they come. So
it's a public process, and it unfolds the way it unfolds.
Right.
You can't anticipate when you're going to be ready to vote on on something.
No.
And I appreciate that Frank sat through all those hearings.
He has done a, he's done a wonderful job staying with us throughout the project. No, and
this isn't his funeral.
No,
he was a good man.
When he comes back, we'll hear it.
Well, given this procedural point, is that going to change anyone's vote? Nobody's going to vote no because they don't like the vote tonight.
That's correct.
Correct. So, I think you're ready for a vote. All those in favor of finding the criteria and approving the decision of the site plan review with all the conditions, say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain?
Aye.
I
think
I have to abstain.
Wait,
right.
You're right.
Yes.
Okay. You
scared me.
That was perfect. That was beautiful.
My head was down.
I'd entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
And seconded. All those in favor of closing the public hearing, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Would hope not.
Well, thank you very much for your hard efforts. Appreciate
motion
it.
Motion
for everything that you guys did to work with us. I really very much appreciate all that.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, if I may close that out with a statement, just stay on top of it.
We'll be watching you.
Hey,
Roy.
Thanks, Roy. 1 second.
Thanks, everyone.
Saw the Board of Health with the, you know, you still have some landscaping and cleanup work on the south side.
We do. Well, this is, you're talking about the Deldrin?
Well, it's both. Yeah. One was, they asked for as-builts.
We gave them all the as-builts.
Okay, but you haven't installed all your vents in it.
They're all in?
They're
all in? Yeah, they're all in the last 2 weeks.
Oh, okay, so those crates are out of there. Okay, I haven't been back.
And by the way, just a funny little story. Did you notice there was a porta potty in front of the PWTF?
Yes.
It blew up for about maybe 6 to 9 months.
Yes.
I called every porta potty company in New England. No one came to ownership.
Really?
PWTF guy didn't order it. Pulte didn't order it. I couldn't find anybody who ordered it. I finally had it taken away.
Hey, thank you.
I have no idea who owns it. Appreciate
it.
Nice
thanks.
Job,
thanks.
Guys.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, you want me to
address
the letter?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you got a letter from the Board of Health relative to... There's a product... There was extensive testing on the whole north side back in 2006 and 2009. And there were two spots that came up with... Slightly, this is 10 years
Merrick?
Ago.
Yeah, okay. Go. Yep.
Just don't beat him up.
Take him
outside. Take him to the woodshed.
Thank you, everybody. Good
take
night.
Care.
Thank you.
Good
night, Mark. We'll talk to you tomorrow. So there's a product called Deldrin, and Deldrin is a pesticide, and was used probably in the nursery for many, many, many years. There were two locations. So under mass guidelines with DEP, if something is even a scintilla above portable levels, it has to be noticed. So on this particular product, the reportable number, I think, is 50 parts per billion. And so it wouldn't be uncommon to see 10,000, 8,000, 20,000. The report back at that time, 10 years ago, came in at 185. So it was like almost non-consequential. The rules are you either have to bury it by 3 feet, remove it, or relocate it and bury it by 3 feet. I will tell you, by the way, Mark and I have discussed this.
Yeah.
We're going to test this one last time. My guess is it's way below reportable now, because after 10 years of rain and everything else, I'm sure it's diluted itself out. But just to show you where the two locations are, one is right here, which is right up against the... Eversource facility, not anywhere near a building.
That isn't part of the property you're given to the town, is it?
No, it is not.
Okay.
No, you can have it if you like. Again,
where's the parking lot over there?
The parking lot is
right next to it. It's right next to it.
near it.
Is there a trailhead over there, too?
Yes. There is. But again, we're going to check it again, okay, just to be safe. So that's that piece. The other location is right down in here. There's probably an area of 4 or 5 homes, maybe 6 homes, that we're going to double check it anyway. We think it's going to be well below reportable. Actually, Haley and Alder just said that actually, because it was done in a friendly atmosphere, it probably is irrelevant at this point. We're going to check it. That's okay. The upshot. And we'll report, once we do that, we'll report that to the Board of Health and the FYI the board.
Okay.
Is under the construction, though, wouldn't you be moving soil anyway?
Oh, absolutely.
So you'd probably, even if you had to, you'd be able to
do first off, we'd rather know what it is.
Right.
Because we had to disturb it. It'd be nice to know, so we're going to do that.
Excellent.
Fairly soon.
Yeah.
And if it's below reportable levels, it's irrelevant.
Yeah.
If it, for some reason it's still over that 185 number, we'll either isolate it, bury it.
Would you post test after as well see?
No, once you find it, you live with it until your end of it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But if it's clean, you don't want to keep testing.
Right, right. You know, I got you. I'm just trying to span that out. But thank you for doing that.
Okay.
But I can check the web for it.
Okay. Look for a motion to adjourn the meeting. Wait a second.
Quick question. Now that Jennifer's back. So we just closed the public hearing on Legacy Farms North.
Correct.
Which was slated for next Monday at 7:30.
No.
It was not.
No, it's Roy's master plan special permit amendment for the 180.
Okay. Never mind then.
Yep.
Never mind.
We're going to put together some kind of outline for that because there's probably a lot that we need to talk about on where we're at.
Mark,
that.
Before you leave, Ken, if you don't mind. Yeah. So Mark has some very up-to-date information for you. They're doing a project in Holliston right now. It's an over 55 development, so it's next town over. And maybe you could give us a little update on the marketability of affordable units.
Yeah.
You've got present information.
Yeah, so I provided some information a month ago. But since that time, we've opened for sales there. We're in our first phase, and we just ran our first lottery. So as Roy said, it's 66 homes. It's age-restricted to one person over 55. It's right on Washington Street as you head towards Milford. And as you said, it's in Holliston. It's right the next town over. Very, very similar community. And we just had our first lottery, and we have over 7 or 8 applicants for the 3 available homes that were in the first lottery. So it was 66 units, 10%, so there were 7 affordable units. And so we did it in 2 different lotteries, 2 different waves. So the first wave had 3 homes available, and we had 7 or 8 seemingly qualified applicants. So what happens now is that we have a lottery agent, and that lottery agent then goes through all the different paperwork and makes that they qualify with the state standards and all the requirements that goes along with that. But it was very promising, and there was a demand for them. Very, very similar, I think.
Well, I know the board have been focused on this project that we just approved tonight and the school project, and then after that, then this one kind of gets up. So next week, Roy, my expectation is we're still focused on this elementary school. We will get started on it, but not very far.
Yes, sir.
I mean,
thank you,
Mark. Because it's down toward Milford.
Yeah,
Roy.
Nice,
congratulations.
Nice milestone.
Okay.
Yep. Appreciate it. Thank
you. Yep.
Good job. Okay.
It's like 1750 Washington Street.
Looking
to adjourn.
Gentlemen. All those in favor of adjourn, say aye.
Aye.
Again,
thank you very much.
Yep.
Take care.
Okay, thank you all.
And great job.